Bop. All right. Go on to my Fauci book, as I like to call it. Fauci.
You going
to
do your echo announcement?
I kind of want to stop doing that.
Oh, it was starting to grow on me.
Yeah, echo announcement?
Well, you'll get to hear it, but everybody else won't get to hear it. But it's basically I go, I say the name of the podcast, and then I got this thing over here that has got, let's see here. Let's see here. See if you guys can hear this. Hello.
Whoa. Hello.
So.
Wait, that's how you introduce the podcast?
Because
that's legit. I like that.
You like that? All right. Well, maybe I'll just keep it then. Maybe I'll just go ahead and keep that. All right. Let me shout out to everybody to go ahead and check out the podcast on my feed. What's on my mind? I want you to go to the podcast. Let's see.
Yeah, I shared it. This is so legit.
This
is what I've been trying to do with my friends forever and a day, but we definitely have mics, and all we had was a couple laptops. We didn't have headphones.
Leo's got the production experience. Actually, I'm just along for the ride.
He's got the hookah experience.
Come in the clutch.
As soon as Eric came in today to the podcast, to the studio, he's all like, dude, your hookah game is all upside down. You need this, you need that. I'm going to give you this, I'm going to give you that. All right? It's all free because you look like a hookah homeless person.
You're like a bum.
And you're a bum. You're a hookah bum.
A hookah bum. What is this? It's raggedy, it jingles.
This is not how you're supposed to do this.
I'm just going
to
give you a new one. You can have my...
Let me set this up. I'm going to get you our hookah.
See, I don't even know what that is.
It's a glass hookah. I'm going to show you a picture.
All right, let me see this. Let me see this bad boy.
I got an extra hookah I'm hooking you up. I got to get rid of it anyway. I got to get a tax write-off.
There you go, yeah.
It's a $400 hookah.
There you go. You will get that.
Chickity check.
This is a biz. Straight up biz.
What? Is it glow in the dark like
that
too?
That's sick, dude.
That's yours.
I like that. Wow, it kind of looks like a scotch glass, or, you know, a decanter. You know?
Yeah, it's got a little light thing that changes colors.
That. Makes me
it
feel
looks like the rosé bottles they pass out at A-Town.
Mm-hmm.
They bring out.
Yeah, sir.
Sparklers.
Make it look all nice and special.
Shameless plug.
Yeah, that's
nice. No, plug.
You know what? I'm missing something.
The hookah? No, there's your mouthpiece.
No, I got a mouthpiece. Oh, snap. Got it.
Your
right.
Beer?
Your the program.
Got my. What are we talking about today? What are we even talking about? All right, cool.
Everything.
Are we back to paper?
Damn right.
We got to get a one note or whatever.
No, dude, I don't. We really don't. We don't. I mean, I'll give it to you. You can type up.
No. I'm not typing anything.
You sure you don't want to type it up?
Nah, I'm good.
You sure you don't want to be the Righteous Anger podcast secretary?
You out of your damn mind?
Because we could use
one. I don't look good in a pencil dress.
I don't know, man.
I got like.
Don't knock it
love
till you try
handles.
It on.
I got like 6 love handles up in here.
It's okay. It's okay. It works.
Okay, I just want to
more
say
cushion
hi.
For pushing.
Hi. That's how I like my Erics. What are you doing?
Flipping it around.
Are you about to like break everything?
Nope.
Hey, everybody on Eric Land. What's up, Eric Land? We don't get to be on Leo Land because Leo Land doesn't exist right now on my phone. So.
Uh-oh.
Although, I could just make it exist with this, couldn't I? I could just do that. Wait a minute.
Are you guys
could
just you plugged in the chargers? Oh, I thought you're not plugged in the mic. I might be going John live here. And
oh,
just...
yeah. I'm charged. Yeah, you should.
Everybody's live.
You should go live. Give me, if you don't need your phone.
You got a charger port?
Or if you want to just point
what
at your
face.
What
you got there? What kind of phone is that?
iPhone 6.
Yeah, me too. Right now.
I'll just go. Where are we going? Facebook live here?
Yeah,
Facebook
everybody's live. On Facebook live.
Facebook live. Tell everybody, just to check you.
All right, yeah, it said come check me out on this. Righteous Anger.
All right, I'm gonna throw out.
We gotta clip that and use it. We gotta clip that and use it. Righteous Anger.
It totally was. We got it, son. All right. Okay. This is hello, hello. Hey, this is to all my people out there in Facebook land that follow me. Listen, go over right now at Righteous Anger Podcast. Okay, go on your Facebook. Search bar and go at symbol Righteous Anger Podcast. Okay. And if you can't spell righteous, go to Google. All right.
Fake
G-O-O-G-L-E. All right. Because I actually just forgot how to spell righteous.
That's cool.
R-I-G-H-T-E-O-U-S.
Yes, you guys helped me out
can
too.
Can you? John was like, "Oh, hey, check it out. We got Jon Hughes."
Hey, you're my live. Hey. I'm your live. You're my live.
So, my gosh, technology. All right, so check it out.
We're all getting cancer right now.
Oh, it's straight. There's so much radiation in this room right now.
It's warming the room.
And, oh my god, it's hot. All right, so I'm going away. This feed is going away. You need to go over to @RighteousAngerPodcast on your search bar, Facebook. Check it out. We are live there right now. I'm saying hello to that feed. All right, peace. Goodbye, friends. All right, cool. So that now goes back to being my research thing. All right, guys, how's everybody doing today?
Yo, amazing.
It's a pretty good day, dude.
It's a good day, man.
Amazing. It was beautiful outside
today. I feel
today.
Like Ice Cube.
Yeah, it was a good day. Preach. Yeah, you know what? We're going to talk a little. We're going to actually put a little bit of rap on.
Nice.
Wait a minute.
We got hip hop or we got like a. Oh, rap. Rap chord.
Rap chord.
I'm saying.
Rap chord.
Wow, that's like a double entendiendo or whatever.
How is that?
Rap Righteous Anger Podcast.
Court.
Rap court.
Snaps. Oh, yo.
Wait a minute.
What?
To all my spellers out there. All right. So basically, we're going to put a rapper. Sorry for those of you who don't listen to rap. Welcome to the 21st century. Get into it. Start in 1976.
Sounds right.
And work your way forward.
Just go watch The Get Down.
Go watch The Get Down. Get hyped up. Then go to my era. All right, the 90s. Check out that rap. It really is the best. And
Big
then,
L.
There's Hip Hop Evolution on Netflix, the documentary.
Oh, yeah,
watch
too.
That one.
There you go.
Go check out Hip Hop Evolution, and then come back, and then you'll be into it. But I'm not going to tell you who we're talking about today, but this person is an offender of the faith of hip hop. All right. That's a little teaser for all of you. All right. I'm going to start off with something. Eric, I want you to go ahead and give me the hookah because you've already had it twice.
All right, well, I'm going to just take a draw.
Take a drag. But then you got to go tippity-tappity on your little typewriter thing. And
tap, Peru.
Tippity-tappity. And then I want you to look up the people who died in the London thing so we can give them proper...
right on.
Yeah. So last week we were kind of remiss. And didn't do moment silence or anything for the people.
Because it had just happened 7 hours earlier.
All right, we do have an excuse. We have an alibi. It just happened. So, but basically we want to give those people, the God bless the dead, as they say. What do the atheists say?
May their dead rest in peace.
But they're dead.
Yeah. May they rest in peace.
How are they, if they don't exist if you're an atheist.
What?
Well.
How are you peaceful if you don't exist?
So atheists don't believe there's any afterlife, right?
No.
All right. So then, yeah.
May they be one with the universe.
One with the earth?
One with the earth, one with the universe.
One with the earth. May they be may they be fossil fuel that helps my car in 2075.
I am terrible about this because I don't actually know a lot about it, but I have a couple of friends who talk about like
carbon
funeral
footprint.
Services for atheists. So
funeral services?
Will you just burn the ashes?
No, not all of them. Some people prefer to be buried in like cardboard boxes and like planted and seeds in the box.
That'd be legit. Yeah. So I've seen that on Facebook once.
Their body like is, you know, fertilizer for a tree.
Yeah.
Is that the same thing like on Facebook where they were talking about turning them into like, they look like little blocks, like cubes, human cube. And then the cube goes
like
in the earth.
Yeah, kind of like that.
Okay.
They're all cool. Right. Got the names.
All right. So
the police officer, the constable... was Keith Palmer. He was 48. Aisha Fraud was another victim. And Kurt Cochran. Those are the names that have been released so far.
All right, we're going to give him a solid 5. Moment of silence. God bless the dead, and... may they rest in peace, as my atheist brother says. All right, so...
I say it. I'm not speaking for all atheists. Some atheists are pretty strange about it. Some are a lot more comforting to the family. They don't say anything too you know.
The actual dead. It's yeah, more yeah, like
there's no like prayer for them. They go and they comfort the living.
Right on.
So.
Okay, so
I got to thank Eric for keeping me on track on that. Thanks, bro.
Thanks, Eric. Thanks, Mr. Herman. I used to know an Eric Herman back in like elementary school, and he was the funniest, legit, the funniest kid in the whole school.
Nice.
And like school, like 600, 800 kids. So, I mean, that's no hard feat. Or wait, no mean feat. All right, I'm going to pass this hookah. Can we establish hookah rules?
Just reach out for it.
Puff, puff, pass.
Reach it when you want it.
Oh, look what you did here.
You got everything all twisted.
Man. We had a system going.
I won't do that again. My bad. All right, guys, we're gonna get right down to business. I'd like to start off. Actually, we already started off with London, so I'd like to go now next into Chelsea Clinton. Did you guys hear?
Oh, man.
Did you hear her tweet?
No.
That family just stay out of politics for 5 minutes.
Let me go ahead and repeat.
I tried to stay away from politics. I got too carried away.
Oh, where you were on Twitter and Facebook going nuts.
I was
you?
On Facebook going nuts.
Oh,
and then
did you lose any friends?
Or
so-called friends?
I don't know. There's some friends that like don't respond to my posts anymore, but they still follow me, or we're still friends on Facebook, but they just don't like my stuff anymore unless it has to deal with something that doesn't have to do with politics yeah. or anything else. Like, what was it? The other day it was like the end of me moving out and moving into somewhere else. I posted that on Facebook and I got like 60 some odd likes, but I posted something else that was politics.
Yeah.
And he got like 4.
What? Okay. Gosh, I had so much to ask you, and then I just kept listening. That's
oh no, go ahead.
That's how you know.
My
no,
bad.
That's how you know you got a good like kind of storyteller guy.
Yeah, this you is, just listen.
So, John, we used to train together at the same MMA gym.
We used to punch each other in the face.
Nice.
I like training with John.
That's kicking each other in the legs.
That's friendly. Yeah.
No, I like training with John because he's what's called a good opponent. Not a bad opponent. He's a good training partner, not a bad training partner.
He hits you with full force?
Hold on. John, let's see.
Let's see
if we're on the same page, though. What makes a good training partner, John?
Good training partner is when the coach says, hey, everybody, you know, we're going to learn today. We're going to go about 20% when you go in there. You know how to go 20%. It's kind of like Crew Chase says it best. It's playing tag. The guy who is playing, who can like just tap you on the cheek and then come back and you can reset, you know, like, hey, you got me. But there's always that one guy. Always that one guy who comes in and he's got something to prove, or he's either been out a while or he came back, or he's new and he's like athletic and he's, oh, I can do this.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Just like powering through it, and he's punching you as hard. You would have thought that he was getting the belt like,
yeah.
in that sparring match. Like, dude, we're learning here.
We're trying to learn. I get it. You're anxious. You're ready to go. But
yeah,
bro.
And nervous too, though.
Yeah,
like,
nervous.
Super nervous. There was a guy, I remember we were sparring, and he was like, that was his first day. He's brand spanking new. We're up in the ring, and we're doing that thing where, like, you go, all right, you get out. You stay in, you know?
Yeah.
Round robin or whatever.
Yeah. Right?
And this kid, I'm not working him, but I'm working him. You know what I mean? I'm like mock working him.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm checking his punches. I'm tapping him. I'm letting him kind of, you know, get some.
Yeah.
It's going well, but here's the problem. He's got that face of terror.
Of only one of us are walking out
yeah,
of here.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh gosh.
And I'm gonna give you.
I'm gonna punch him.
Oh my god! You would have thought that like. Spartacus! Like, we had swords or something.
I have to avenge my family.
Oh, my God. I thought, did I murder your family?
I didn't know.
Did I say something?
What did I say to your mom? I don't know what I said, but I said something. Because this kid, the look on his face was like terror and anger and all the... If you looked at my face, if you did like a, you know, look at his face, look at my face real quick, it was like, my face.
Easy guy, easy.
All right, 1-1-2-1-3 3-2-3 You know what I mean? I'm just going through the motions and whatever. Check. You know, and he's going balls to the wall, and then finally the bell rings. Now, anybody who's trained, you hear a bell ring. you immediately stop.
Yeah, like
it's done.
Done.
High five.
High five. You know, I got. I'm ready to like you know do the high five or do the you know punch the thing.
Punch gloves.
We're done. We're good. Yeah, right. You're done. And this dude thrashes an elbow. Does like a perfect. He did this. I knew it was an accident because it was the first day. He does like a perfect, like 6-12 elbow on me, and just bust my lip wide open, blood everywhere. Oh my gosh, man! I'm like, yep, newbie. Only newbies. I only ever really got hurt two times against newbies and against a guy named Leonard. That's it. Do you remember Leonard? Do you know who that is?
No, I don't think so.
That was before.
Was that Fightworks?
That was Fightworks.
Fightworks days. I wasn't there at Fightworks.
Leonard had to be taking roids. Had to be on the juice. Had to be. He looked like he was on the juice. He
felt like he was on the juice.
Yeah, he acted like he was on the juice. That dude knew it was like my first couple of weeks at Fightworks, and that dude was sparring with me. Now he's like a standard. Had to be 250. Okay, maybe.
Holy crap.
220.
So his 20% was too much.
His 20% is like our 40 to 50 probably.
Yeah, he should.
And on the juice, you add 65, maybe 70.
He was going like, I know there's no such thing as past 100%, but maybe there is. Maybe there is. So, man, I end up sparring with this dude. I literally know nothing about Muay Thai. Nothing.
Brand new.
Brand spanking. And this dude.
Wait, had he already trained already?
Oh, he was there for like 5 years. Like
oh.
He was good. He's had a bunch of amateur fights. I think he was going pro at the time or something. I don't remember, but he was a fighter. Okay, he was on the fight team. And this dude hit me in the ears, so like bow, 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 and I'm just like, I don't know how to block. I don't even know what I'm doing. That dude gave me water, like water. You know how you have that water feeling, like you have water in your head.
Mm-hmm.
For 6 weeks straight, I was like, that's it. I'm gonna feel like I have water in my brain for the rest of my life. Thanks.
This guy's
dude.
Name's Leonard.
Leonard, man.
I gotta get this guy's number.
I'm not gonna say his loud. You don't want his number, dude.
No, I need to know a couple bruisers just in case.
Just in case. You never know.
$1,000,
hire that guy. So yeah, that's okay. So that's just. I don't want to get into the MMA stuff yet, but
all right.
That's just a little taste of that. So Chelsea Clinton, I know that's where we were. Chelsea Clinton, this is what she tweets. She goes, so there's a picture of Abraham Lincoln with one of those red Make America Great hats on. And this dummy goes, I hope this was Photoshopped.
You think? That or Trump has got some explaining to do about his time machine.
I was like, did Chelsea have a stroke too?
Wow.
Does that run in the family, strokes? Because there's no way she had.
She's got at least 20 years before she has her stroke.
You would think, right? But you know what the scary part is? That means she tweeted with her right mind.
Oh, she said, please tell me this is Photoshopped.
Please tell me this is Photoshopped.
No, not at all. Actually. Ask Trump about his time machine.
Yeah, seriously.
Please, Chelsea, go ask.
What, you want one? What are you saying?
Yeah, like, go up there and really find out if you got one or not.
Sorry. I'm just wondering what Lincoln would say if he met Trump. Like, I'm curious, like, okay.
Like, yeah, they got you too? You had been over.
Trump's scaring the shit out. Oh, I just did it.
Yeah, just,
sorry.
It's okay. Roll
Look
it.
At
roll
you.
It.
No, sorry. See?
Shiitake mushrooms
I get
out
a,
of me.
I get
Shih Tzu.
Man, I get a few beers in me, and
scaring just, my Shih Tzu dog out
it,
of me.
It just goes, yeah, it just scared the Shih Tzu out of me.
I hate to make a crass joke, but that's probably why he was shot in the head if he was wearing the hat. It's like, oh, MAGA, pow!
You're telling me he's in Forge Theater just chilling with his hat
with
on?
The red hat, and people are like, take
How
the hat
dare
off.
You?
Take the
theater.
Hat off. You're in a theater.
No, but you know what? Every time you saw the dude, he had the big, like, tall hat, so he had to take that hat off, and then he had the other hat
underneath.
You know, he didn't even have a hat. He had, like, a skull cap. He was gangster with it. He had a red Make America Great skull cap.
Do-rag.
A do-rag. That's the same thing. Yeah, make America great, G. What's up, homie? I kind of hope that.
Gosh, I would just want to see the skit.
Would that be awesome if Lincoln was the first one to ever speak in Ebonics.
That'd be pretty cool.
That's why they blew his head off.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, they were like, "There's no president of ours." What was the guy? John Wilkes Booth?
Yep.
Supposedly?
Or allegedly.
Allegedly? Is that?
No, he really did it.
Okay, so there's no conspiracy theory?
He jumped from the balcony seat and like landed on the theater and broke his leg, kind of shattered it. And then he ran.
And still ran away.
Ran on it. Like, okay, that
guy. Yeah, you would too.
What
man.
A G.
Jeez Louise. Freaking hit and run, literally, right?
Yes, Chelsea. It's photoshopped.
Jeez Louise. Let me see what is going on up in here. So, yeah, I'm checking out my Facebook feed. What's up, Elise? How you doing? Elise is on my feed. I love Elise because, you know what? I learn about everything. Everything pop culture, I learned from her.
Oh, wow.
She's my connect as far as pop culture goes.
She's your pop source?
She's my pop source.
She's the plug.
Elise, you want a job, you can be like the, what do they call that on TV shows? The one that talks about the, like what's going on in the pop culture world?
I have no idea what you're referring to.
Come on, man. You know, like on TV and stuff.
Somebody does like the...
A commercial? A flash? Yeah. Flash news?
Yeah, like when you're on news.
News flash.
Not a
flash news.
No. Now our pop culture story brought to you by Elise.
Yeah, like a correspondent.
She's our segment.
Our top five at five.
Top five at five. I like that.
That's
Elise,
pretty good.
Our make
pop,
it happen.
Top five at five.
Top five. I'm messing that all up.
The pop top at five.
Pop that top.
Something like that.
Something
nope,
like that.
We butchered it.
Yeah, that's
it's done.
That's done. Dave Chappelle special. Who saw it?
I didn't see it yet.
Are you kidding me?
My buddy keeps yelling at me.
Oh, man. You're not missing anything.
What? He said the first one wasn't too funny, but the second one was pretty hilarious.
Apparently he mellowed out, is what a lot of people are saying.
Man, Dave Chappelle is done. But I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean like...
He's fed up.
I've never made $20 million for an hour of work.
I've never made... $50 million and then said, haha, I'm out. And took off, know, right? Took like, off to Africa.
I'm well, rich.
Y'all could have just stopped at I never made.
Yeah,
yeah
that's
right?
All you need to do.
I never made a million.
Never
so.
Made it. Dave Chappelle's special, it wasn't Killing Them Softly. It wasn't, you know, live at, forget the other one, whatever the other
the
one.
Apollo.
No, the Apollo. Was it the Apollo?
No.
No, okay. He might have done the Apollo.
I don't know if anybody does the Apollo anymore.
Oh, I don't even know either. I should know. I'm black.
No, one was in Austin.
Yeah, and I think that was the better one, but that was like filled with a bunch of his old jokes.
Yeah, which, I thought we were all right.
Which were hilarious. No, I think he had good jokes, but I think that
the four stories of I'm gonna ruin it for you a little bit, John. The four stories of meeting OJ, those are pretty funny.
The hilarious, yeah.
Yeah, those are really funny.
That was pretty good, but you know, like if you remember Killing Him Softly, Crack Baby, Selling Crack or whatever, the limo, the first time he saw Native Americans at Walmart, and he was like, "I learned about y'all in social studies."
Oh my god!
It was nowhere near as funny as that. But you know, you look at Dave Chappelle. The Dave is like older,
pushing 50,
wiser,
way wiser. His trip to Africa,
South Africa, at that. I mean, yeah. Like apartheid Africa. No, you know, I mean, it wasn't during apartheid, but you know, there's still like glimmers of that. And he said they treated him really well out there.
That's nice.
And now if you look at, like I watched a couple of Dave, like news segments or whatever. I forget what channel it was, but I was watching something, and they were like doing interviews with him, and like they went to his hometown in Connecticut, and that dude, I mean, he literally is like king of the town without being a celebrity, like. He's a celebrity, but they don't treat him like a celebrity is usually, you know, that is being treated.
Yeah.
So he doesn't like walk down the street and it's like, oh, dang. And then there's like a line of people just following him and paparazzi. And so he.
It's like, what's up, Dave?
They followed this dude. Dave was like walking down the street and like, Dave, hey, what's going on? Hey, Dave, it's Dave. You know, what's going on? And he goes up to a guy in a 10-gallon hat during this thing. He walks up to the guy, hey, how's your brother, man? How is this? Mom still okay? And then, yeah, Dave, she's doing really well. Like what? That's Dave Chappelle, dude. Hey, but
yeah, that's my best friend. That's one of my, I talk to him every day.
Every day.
Dave Chappelle.
Dave comes down by the saloon, man, and we just, you know, knock back a couple beers and
drink some whiskey, you know, have a good old time.
Good old time.
He's got it figured out.
He actually started a juke joint. You guys know what a juke joint is?
No.
It's like
it's a jukebox.
Okay, that's what I was going to ask. Like a jukebox?
Like everybody goes to this place at the same time. And it's basically like, we're all going to show up at the same time. We're all going to party at the same time. We're all going to leave at the same time. You go in there, it looks like hoedowns are happening inside the place. It's got like, you know, corrugated metal stuff on the ceiling.
It's got the mechanical bull.
Mechanical. It looked like it might have a mechanical bull in there. And Dave basically goes up there. He has like musical acts come.
Nice.
And, you know, basically what he did at Block Party, if y'all remember that.
Uh-uh.
You don't remember Dave Chappelle's Block Party?
Uh-uh.
Oh, it was huge, man. It was in New York. I believe it was New York. Yeah, New York. But yeah, big Block Party. Just have a bunch of people out, listen to great music, smoke not hookah. And,
oh, yeah.
Beautiful.
Lots of that.
Lots of not hookah.
It's a beautiful thing.
And and he probably goes up there, tells some jokes and whatnot, but... Dave is enjoying life. I mean, is there...
I told you, man. He has it figured out.
I mean, you got to be wise if you're walking away from $50 million. Like, nah, I don't want it. I'm going to South Africa to hang out and chill.
Did you hear his joke? When he comes back, he's... I think this was that he did like a... What do you call it when... not a valedictorian. What do you call it? A commencement speech, right? For like college, university.
Yeah, they usually bring in a guest speaker.
So he was a guest speaker. He did a commencement speech, and he goes, people thought I was crazy when I left $50 million on the table. But what do they think now? I came back and made $60 million. Let's see.
They like me now.
Less work.
$50 million for a season. $60 million for three-hour-long specials.
Let me see here.
And all he had to do was go get his life together in between. Come on now.
That's pretty sweet.
Who's the smart guy? Who's the smart guy?
You know, he probably gets a lot of his material from all that social interaction.
Oh, my gosh.
You know how many funny stories he gets told just by hanging out with people?
Every comedian out there will tell you, any good comedian will tell you that they live life. That's how they get their jokes. They live life. They experience. Just watch Louis C.K.'s show.
Yes. Yeah, he always talks about his kids.
Louis C.K., if you watch his show,
it's his stand-up. It's his life.
That's his life.
Yeah, that's daily life. Like Seinfeld, a show about nothing.
Exactly.
It's their life. That's what happens all the time. I sit there and that stuff happens to me all the time.
Yeah,
I'm like, no way, this is only going to happen to me. But no, you look around, everybody has that same stuff. It's absolutely nothing.
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, people live some boring lives out there too, and they're not. They wouldn't have very much material for an hour-long special.
Get boring real quick.
And then I went to the store, and there was this lady, and she took 6 hours. Okay, get it? Okay, all right. Next joke. Boo! Nothing worse than that. Boo!
You get the clown come out with the hook.
Yeah, oh my gosh. We need more clowns with hooks for sure. They did that at the Apollo. I think that was one of the best things they did at Apollo.
No, you took.
Boo! Oh, jeez.
Blew it out. Wow. My bad.
Oh, God.
Turn my level down.
It was a strong boo.
I cannot take you anywhere. Yeah.
Boo!
Definitely. That's you. See that large spike right there?
Neat.
That's you. All right. So, speaking of life, right? So I got this idea for a show.
All right, let's lay it down there.
Now, y'all know.
Pitch it.
Y'all, I'm going to pitch it to the world. All 100 of you.
Careful, somebody will steal it.
I know, right? Too bad I got, well.
This is copyright as soon as you say
it. Yeah, it is. Actually, yeah, it's recorded, time stamped.
It's published.
Yeah.
Shoot.
Steal it. I dare you.
It's now property of Facebook.
Apparently. Exactly. No, exactly. Freaking Facebook, man. Actually, that's kind of worrisome. Maybe we should stop recording this right now.
All right. Bye, Facebook.
Bye, everybody.
We're going to cut for 5 minutes. We'll be back.
Yeah. I need to talk to my lawyer. Now, I got this idea. Now, let me ask you a question. Where'd you grow up?
Multiple areas. I was born here in Fairfax, in Fort Belvoir, and then moved around for a little bit, was raised here through my childhood, but then like elementary school was in Panama, and then half of it was in Panama, half of it was in North Carolina.
What are you, military brat?
Yeah.
Which service?
Army.
Army,
both
okay.
Parents
All
were
right.
in the, both parents were in the Army.
That's Eric.
And then Pop stayed in there for extra long, but he got out after they were like, hey, we need you in Germany. He was like, nah, I can't go over there. I got
three
kids. I can't do that. Yeah. So, but I went elementary school and middle school was all in North Carolina. And then high school was all up here growing up around here. So I got my manhood up here.
All right. And what year did you graduate high school?
2006.
Okay, all right. Let me ask you this then, all right? You can take it'll take a second, so you can go ahead and rip on that. But rip on the hookah, for those of you wondering what I'm talking about.
Right? Everybody's
tuning this
in.
Is a family-friendly show. This is a family. This is a hookah.
Yeah, it's a hookah. Nothing more, nothing less.
But it really
less.
Is. It really is hookah.
It's fantastical. All right, so growing up, and I imagine that maybe you had the same experience as me, right? But growing up in high school and middle school and all that, when you got, did you guys like make fun of each other, the boys?
Oh yeah.
Oh, the show. Yeah. No, I'm not gonna mess it up.
All right.
Oh yeah.
I just remember what you're referring
like,
to.
Like to the point where we're all in tears of like laughter.
Laughter, right?
Almost like we had to laugh or we'd be angry at each other.
Exactly. Right. And you're always trying. You're always ready for it every day.
Yeah.
You're ready for a session like that to start up.
You're at home writing jokes, getting ready.
Getting ready on each one of the guys who are the best. You're trying to figure out how to.
It's like he ain't gonna roast me today. Not today.
All right. Now, what did you call that?
I mean, shooting the shiitake mushrooms. I mean, just,
oh, nice. Yeah. Shooting.
That's
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
That's
just,
it?
Just shooting anything. Like
that's like what old.
Johnning on each other.
Whoa,
oh,
stop.
He said it.
Wait, doing what on each other?
Johnning on each other?
Okay. All right. So, growing
up. But I don't know how to spell that. Don't ask me to spell it.
So, all right. So, this is my thing, right? I want to do a show, right? Where we go and we have that.
A diss battle.
Basically a diss battle. Now, when I was growing up in high school, we called it joning on each other.
Yeah.
So, I'm talking
about joning.
Joning, yeah. It's spelled the same, but that's what we call it, right? And I'm like, I'm sitting there, man, this is a great idea. We had a good time, and there's kids out there that are nasty. Nasty with it. Is it my turn?
Yeah.
There's some kids you just can't compete with, and you knew once they entered in, everybody just sit back and let him just rip apart everybody.
Right. The best. All right. Why don't you do it? Because I always mess it up.
What?
The only way to win.
Oh, wait. No, I'm not doing it.
The only way to win is to not play the game. I know I'm messing that quote up, but war games, man. So.
Would you like to play a game?
So I. That's an 80s reference, by the way, in case you didn't know. There's a lot of kids out there like, what are they even talking about?
Strange game.
Man, that happens too often.
Yeah, I know.
Kids are like, what? I don't get it.
Kids don't get it. I know. And it used to be cool to be random. Now it's not, so whatever.
I stick to random.
Random. So the idea, I want to call it Jonin. Call the show Jonin, right? Can y'all even hear that?
No, I don't think they can.
All right.
The only winning move is not to play.
The only winning move is to not play.
Is not to play.
See, I'll get it one day.
Yeah.
So, one day.
We'll work on it.
You guys get it.
Practice makes perfect.
You know what I'm saying. So I'm like, man, I'm going to call it Jonin. And then I go talk to this kid, right, who works with us over at Vicker Studios. And, you know, he's 21 years old, you know, about to be freshly out of college. Hey, man.
Brand new adult.
And I said, hey, man, I got this idea for a show, and I'm, you know, I'm trying to tell him about the show. And I said, I'm calling it Jonin. And he's like, what? Like, Jonin. Oh, man, that's not what we call it. Well, what do y'all call it? He goes, no, man, that's cooking.
Cooking.
Cooking. Oh, roasting.
Roasting.
Oh, okay, all right.
Roasting, yeah. Cooking.
Yeah.
Okay, I get you now.
So apparently they call it something different. They call it cooking now, so I'm like, should I change the name of the show to Cooking so the kids today will get it? Or should I keep it all the way OG and just call it Jonin?
Keep it OG and keep it Jonin.
It's the children that are wrong.
The children are always wrong. You're right, man.
It'll come back around because if you name it Jonin, it gets popular. They'll see it and they'll be like, oh, man, you seen that show Jonin?
Oh, man,
Jonin, bro.
Hey, you're right. No, wow. You know what?
There you go.
I might have to recruit you in my sales department.
Just taking it back.
Let me know. We got Monday and Thursdays,
dude.
9 to 3.
Holy cow! So Jonin is what we're gonna call it. Ra, that's the dude's name that told me it was cooking. and I was thinking, I'm like, man, area area high schools, right, where you film them do a competition, like a rap battle type of thing, just shot the same way.
Like a
just
tournament.
A ton of kids, tournament, and you got like the king versus the contender.
I got you.
And then whoever wins in that whatever that school gets to go up to the next thing, which is like the district level.
And national. Then, go to national.
And then finally you get up to national, and I'd say international, but then you got jokes that people don't even understand. So then it's like,
yeah, the Scottish jokes won't make a whole lot of sense.
Oh man, he roasted you. I got you.
What?
That's bad.
Yo, man, Angus just roasted you, son. Angus, man. Or God forbid, man. Freaking what was I gonna say? I was gonna say British. Have you seen the British now they're starting to do like British diss battles?
Oh my gosh.
Oh my god. Nothing worse than
you boil your water with a microwave.
Well, no, it's just
that's like the epitome of a British diss.
Yeah,
so everybody freaked out. No, we didn't.
No, you didn't. No, it just feels like you're watching a rap battle or diss battle.
That one show on MTV they used to have
on BBC or something.
No. Your mama. I think it was called Your Mama.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that
it was.
One.
It was, but that was like so. I mean, your mama jokes is okay, but yeah. I'd rather open it up to.
There's only so many your mama jokes.
That kid's five head.
Be surprised. They had a CD back in the day that did that. Remember? You remember that? I have to look up the title. Let me look it up.
A CD? Like,
there was a couple of albums of these disses that were like all your mama jokes.
Oh, really?
Oh, I remember. It was called Snaps.
Snaps, that's right. Yeah, I do remember Snaps. But then it became lame. It's like as soon as you do that, it becomes lame. Oh, bathroom break. Healthy guy. Here, can you move that for him carefully? Watch the bass. We're losing our guest already. Can you believe it? Nice. All right. While he's doing that, I'm going to send out another reminder. Let people know.
Oh, there was a show called Wildin' Out.
Oh, yeah. I think that's still going on.
Joshin' is what it was called in Norfolk.
Joshin', yeah.
And Norfolk.
Norfolk. I remember that because some of the kids at my school actually called it that, Joshin'.
Quit joshing me, man.
But that was kind of lame. Like, where I'm from, that was kind of a lame. Joshin' was like what the lame kids said. Jonin was the cool kids. Roastin' wasn't a thing. And then all the old heads called it the dozens.
The dozens?
Yeah. Apparently, back in the day, they called it playing the dozens. That's where, you know, dudes would get together in these like rings and basically just, you know, have at it, just completely decimate.
A word battle.
Word battle, yeah.
Nice.
Like, look at your head. Look at your head. You know, something like that. Let's see. Out.
Yeah, Snaps was foul, man. They had a lot of good jokes in Snaps. And they made them all the way through, what, 2010?
It was really bad.
Yeah, they were foul jokes, man.
Really?
The cult of the snap.
Like who?
The
like
best
who,
of snap.
Like who sold that?
Snaps?
Yeah.
I don't know.
It was Viacom. They own everything.
They pretty much do.
Viacom put out Snaps.
Oh my gosh, they had four albums? Six?
Oh, man.
James Pursley.
I can't even read my own handwriting. Oh, okay. So, all right.
What's next on the agenda?
All right. So, next thing I want to, like, just kind of ask questions to John about you.
Oh, dear.
See what y'all think. When did panhandling become a 9-to-5-er?
When you can make $60 an hour.
Jeez Louise, dude.
Yeah.
These guys are getting serious.
Yeah, I don't even donate anymore because I can't tell. If they're like, this is their daily job, because I've seen the video where you get, you're out there in your homeless outfit, and then you're done, you go and get in your business outfit, and you're like, all right.
You'd be out there for 4 hours, you make like, you know, 240 bucks, 300 bucks.
Yeah, 300 bucks.
Dude getting into his like, his suit or whatever, he's like, oh, time to go to my side job.
Nice. Yep.
Time to go where I make my money.
Yeah. Done for the day. That's so ridiculous though, because I mean, like, you got one dude. This is what I saw, right? I'm on the about to make a turn, right? And that's where that's like the prime real estate where they get you. You know, like you're waiting to make a turn. It's taking like 3 hours for the light to turn.
And they're eyeing you.
And they're eyeing you. They're looking at you. They're walking down the thing, walking back up, walking back down, got their sign. But then there's another dude similarly dressed with a backpack, like a nice backpack. Sometimes they don't even, this is what I don't get. Sometimes they're
Why not hide it?
They're not even dressed bad. Sometimes they're dressed better than I am.
Like they're recently homeless.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, and that's what you tell yourself. Like, you know, you're like, oh, maybe he's, you know.
Maybe he just got out of here.
Lost everything in the recession.
In the recession, yeah. But then you look at, you guys remember that Occupy Wall Street thing?
Yeah.
And then you started to kind of see, hey, not everybody here is honest. This ain't 100%.
Can't trust nobody nowadays.
I know, man. And you know, like, you know, being a Christian myself, it's like, you really don't want to turn away people. You know what I mean? You really don't. You want to do the right thing. You want to help somebody in need. Like, that's a call.
Yeah.
But
you don't want your kindness to be taken advantage of.
Exactly.
Yeah, well, that and, I mean, like, I don't know. It's just like, Eric, if you came to me right now.
Yeah.
Right? And you said, dude, I need 20 bucks.
I need $1,000, Leah.
Okay, now you're pushing it.
I know.
But if you said 20 bucks.
Let's keep it triple digits.
Give me a 20, man.
If you said, dude, I need a couple hundred,
huh.
I'd be like, all right. You know why? Because we have that rapport. I know you. I know your situation. Just because you make money, right, in a job doesn't mean that I can't help you out, right?
I got to get that rock, Leo. Give me some cash.
And that's therein lies one of the problems. Like, crack balls. Like, I don't know what they're...
This is how you find out if they're fake or not.
All right.
You give them food.
Yeah, there you go.
If you give them food and they throw it back at you and they say, ah, it's for money. You know darn right that either A, you're going to be fueling their habit, which you don't want to do, or B, this dude's fake.
There you go. There's a litmus test.
Keep a box of MREs in the car.
Just be there, like, you go, buddy.
This is good for like a month.
Keep a pack of fruit snacks.
Actually,
just chuck it and pelt him.
Lunchables.
Just pelt him as you drive by, like, boom.
Dude, here you go, buddy.
People at my church, they do this cool thing where they'll, like, actually make homeless
kits,
and then give them to people and say, hey, you see somebody homeless, socks, weatherproof jacket, snacks, I'm just kidding. See, my joke just fell flat, so let's pretend like rewinds.
It's like wrapped. It's got like wrapping paper on it, and if you look closely, they're actually job applications.
Job applications. Get a job, you bum.
This place said they'll take you. They'll take anybody.
They'll take anybody.
Sign your name here.
Starbucks.
You can donate a kidney, man. You'd be out of poverty like that.
Yeah, you got to start.
Dude, I know.
A couple grand in your pocket.
I was talking to this this young lady, who at my church. Who actually gave a lady a kidney. Didn't know her.
Just gave it.
That's
real low. What?
I just look at her like,
don't even know her.
I need my kidney.
I got two. I don't need the other one.
I don't need the other one. I guess she doesn't have
a drinking. I got two lungs. You want this one too?
Oh my gosh.
I'm all for the helping hand, but
I got
no.
An ear. I got two hands.
I got two. I got two for a reason.
Yeah, right. I got a backup. Mine. It's called a backup, right?
I can't wait till we can clone them. Oh, you need a kidney? Here, let's go. Let's go print one.
Dude, actually, it's in my pack. I got a kit.
It's
I brought
ice.
An extra one today.
Yeah. Here you go. Here you go. You need a lung? Got it.
Honestly, tech talk real quick. The most important thing we could start cloning and like giving to people is kidneys and pancreases. Diabetes is like killing people.
Mm-hmm.
And people have to be on dialysis for years. So if we ever get to the point where we could clone an organ... Those are the two most important ones we need to start cloning.
We just stop poisoning our food and...
Oh, you know, I mean...
Making it all sweet and all making sugar. Everybody addicted to sugar. Hey, have all this Kool-Aid with half a tub of sugar in it.
I mean, we really are off the chain with that, aren't
we? Let's give you some diabetes. Oh, what? You got diabetes? Come on over.
That old walrus guy. Do you have diabetes?
Diabetes.
Do you have diabetes? Call this number. We will make money off
you.
Let's
help you out now.
Somehow,
we will help you. Give me money.
You're going to need all these pills over and over and
talking
over.
Talking about Wilford Brimley?
Yeah, there
Wilford
he is.
Wilford Brimley, yep. No. I've got diabetes, too.
What's his name? The comedian Patrice. He had diabetes.
Yeah, see, we'd have Patrice if we could clone pancreases.
Can we get a 5 minute, or excuse me, a 5 second for Patrice, please?
No, you can have a second.
You get out.
We gave 5 seconds to four victims earlier.
Yeah, well, he was about as big as four victims, so yeah, 5 seconds. Okay. 5 seconds. I had to give that to my man, Patrice O'Neill, my favorite.
He was hilarious.
Favorite comedian ever.
Ain't that better?
Ain't that better? Ain't that better?
No, it is not. Leave me alone.
Yeah, he that dude honestly transcended comedy. Like, he was more than a comedian. So go check him out. Patrice O'Neill, P-A-T-R-I-C-E, Pat Rice. That's how you spell it. O'Neill, not spelled in the real way, spelled in the black way. O apostrophe N-E-A-L.
Needless to say, he was not Irish.
He was not a small Irish woman.
Fact.
Not an Irish woman. He was a big black man.
He might have been. I don't know.
He was a giant black man from Boston. Funniest comedian I've ever experienced, and I've experienced them all.
If did he have type 1 or type 2? Because type 2 is the one that you get from too much sugar.
He said he ended up getting it as a youth. So
he had juvenile diabetes.
Yeah.
And he made it a long way.
Made it a long time, man. Made it a long time. Died when he was like 41.
I remember they were roasting him on one of the roasts on Comedy Central. And they brought up diabetes and like talking about, cracked a joke about cutting off his left foot.
Yeah.
And then like a month and a half later, he was gone.
He was dead. And then they're like,
oh, man.
How do you feel now? He'd be laughing though, whatever.
Oh, yeah, he would be laughing. Yeah.
That's the great thing about comedy and comedians. Like, real comedians don't get their feelings hurt, man. They don't.
Dude, that's what I love about the freaking Joe Rogan podcast. They roast each other
all the time.
They cook. They cook each other all the time.
Yeah. They're joning all the time. Yeah, and, you know, we live in such a PC culture right now. It's so, so freaking annoying.
Ridiculous.
That, you know, and it's like everybody's watching their back. Everybody feels like they got to watch their back with that stuff.
Everybody's like, real, real sensitive.
So, and like sensitive on the low, though. I mean, outwardly, but not on the inside. Like, go home with any one of these people. Go home with any. Go in the car.
Type 2.
Oh, yeah, type 2?
Yeah.
Okay, so he got it from the sweets.
He was also a letterman, and he was convicted of rape.
Statutory rape. Hilarious story.
He's got to go. Yeah, he probably has a bit about that.
Oh, it was Opie and Anthony.
No way.
He talks about exactly what happened, and it was a setup. But
it didn't fall into the whole princess, the sweetheart clause. In most states, they have a sweetheart clause for people who are like 2 or 3 years apart. He didn't fall into that. She was 15, and he was 18, I think.
He explains it like...
I've been there.
Yeah, it's a weird spot to be in, honestly.
He explains it like...
Very weird.
Like this. They hooked up. She was actually hooking up with him and a bunch of other guys. A couple. I'm not going to say a bunch. Her and her girlfriend. And apparently, the judge who was normally like... he was... The judge that tried him got in trouble previous to his case for being too lenient. So he had to make an example, and he explained it to him at in the courtroom. He said, look, I've got to come down on you, you know, and... Anyway, go check it out. It's on YouTube.
Good story.
Yeah, yeah. It's actually, of course, the way he tells it's hilarious. But anywho, that's so weird to say. Oh yeah, this rape story is hilarious. if you hear the story
one time,
if you hear the story and hear it from his words, get that perspective. You'll
appreciate it a lot.
Come back and tell me what you think. All right, that actually would be a good topic or a good thing to talk about. All right.
What's up on our agenda next, sir?
I really don't like the agenda-driven thing.
All right, so what do you got next on your
mind?
That's
what we're doing. What's up, Chris? Chris Merritt, my man.
Chris Merritt.
Chris is a beast. Chris is a guy. All right, so Chris owns Beyond Strength, which is...
Hey,
check the shirt out, Beyond Strength Performance.
Hey, shameless plug-in right here.
Still in Sterling, right?
Yes.
All right.
We're just down the street from where we were before.
Okay.
Which, by the way, you got to come out and see the new gym, man.
I'm about to move there.
I got to go check it out.
Really? We're out in Sterling.
Was it Dominion Station?
Sterling
Park.
Oh, okay. Off the boulevard?
Off 28 and 7, right in the corner.
Oh, okay. I know where you're at now. Okay, I got
it's like
you.
5 minutes out of the mall.
That's the good part of Sterling.
Now,
a decent part of Sterling.
Now everybody's
not so bad part of Sterling.
Yeah.
So now everybody know. Well, you want to give them your phone number too while you're at it?
I'll give them my blood type if they want to know it.
I don't even know my blood type.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I have no idea.
Dude, you better get that.
I should probably figure it out, right?
Yeah, you should check it out,
just
man.
In case.
Just in case.
Dude, you never know. It might be AIDS O negative for all you know.
Oh, my
sure,
God.
Sure, through all these fights, they could have told me at least once, hey, this is your blood type.
Hey, by the way.
By the way, you should never get AB blood. It'll kill you.
Oh, okay.
Okay, good to know.
Good to know now.
I really could have used that information before you put AB blood in me. Thanks.
So a not-so-shameless plug, because Beyond Strength, they really do... They really do their work out there. I go to, like, you know, Chris and you and Chris do a good job, like, you know, doing videos, promoting the thing. And
Dude, that's all Chris and Todd. Chris is a mastermind. You know, he doesn't even do, like, he just uses iMovie.
Yeah.
And I'm like, dude, you're pretty boss at this.
Well.
And he's been literally the website, the videos, like the gym, he's all... It's not come off the top of his head, but he brainstorms it. He shoots the idea to Todd, and him and Todd have been in this since the beginning. Mm-hmm. And he shoots the idea to him, and the next thing you know, they have this big old video or this big idea or this big thing coming, and here we are crushing it now.
See,
what is it now? Almost 6 years
see,
later, five,
nice.
6 years later.
Action, 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 action. That's why I tell anybody. So I own Vicker Studios, right? So my business is production, right? Is creating video and film and all that, right? And I tell people all the time, man, you know, my phone is recording right now, so I can't use that as an example, but take out that production studio in your pocket and get started. You know what I'm saying? Take out your iPad. It's got a camera.
Start now.
Get your name out there. You know what I mean? Nothing worse than you've got your phone. This is not my phone, but whatever. You got your phone, and it's all you're doing is making calls and looking at stuff. You're not really doing anything with it. You've got something that literally 15, 20 years ago did not exist.
It was magic.
This is magical.
You had to take it to a studio somewhere else. They had to do it on a computer, then send it to another computer.
The amount of
cut, slice, dice.
The amount of time and money involved in doing what you can do right now, right this second, and publish it. I mean, let alone right now, the live feed thing, this is relatively new. We weren't able to do this. Now we can do this. This right here is television. We're on TV right now.
This is internet television.
Did you know you'd be on TV someday?
Not today. I didn't think I'd be on TV,
I'm
but here we are.
You're on TV, man.
And two broadcasts.
Check me. I'm glad I wore my hat and glasses, the good glasses. Look at that.
You look very smart. Very smart. So
it's all a show.
I want to give Chris... and the guys over at Beyond Strength Performance, big ups. You guys are working absolute magic out there. I see the transformations that you guys are making on people out there.
It's amazing.
So if you guys are in the D.C. metro area and you need a place to like actually become strong, actually become mobile, actually become a monster, a beast, stronger than you are now, better than you are now, faster, sexier, might I add,
yeah, no kidding.
All right, show.
Have you seen Chris? Oh, I don't got the abs today. No. We just got like 3 more weeks till springtime.
He didn't bring his abs to the.
No.
To the
I
thing.
Got the beer belly today.
All right. Oh, no. Well, I tell you, it's amazing what they're doing. So definitely go check them out. What's the web address?
BSBNova.com. But you can also go on to Google, and you can look up Sterling CrossFit, Sterling Lifting, Sterling Kettlebell, Dallas Kettlebell, anything like that, anything you're probably interested in, and we are probably going to pop up. You can also do that with the Disciple side too. Disciple or Sterling MMA, Dallas MMA, 9 times out of 10, Google's going to put Disciple MMA up there.
I will give you, and I'll give you this. You guys are fun too.
Oh, so much fun.
You guys are fun. Like, I've worked at so many different gyms. I've worked at 3 Globo gyms. I've worked in a small practice. I actually worked as an instructor with the guys that now own
Disciple.
And I got to tell you, the guys over there, the girls over there, they're so much fun. They're great to work with. So that's just another plug I want to give you guys, just because of the good times that I did have while I was there. All right, and then actually, this is a good segue. So I'm going to ask you some questions.
Pop quiz, hot shot.
Are you ready for some questions?
Never.
Did you know? I want to ask you. Actually, I'm going to start off with a story. Story first, then questions.
Story time.
All right, story time. So the other day, all right, I'm getting this haircut. Let me see what this haircut looks like. Hold on a second.
Oh, boy. Check the hair.
Oh, my gosh. I got hat head. Well, anyways, I got this awesome faux hawk. Which I've been wanting a faux hawk. I went to a place.
So 2012.
That's all right, man. Hey, you know what? I'm 34. That's new.
This is new to me.
But man, I went to this lady before I went to this guy that did it right, and I was like, "Do you know how to do a faux hawk?" And she's like, "Yes."
Yes, give me your money.
This chick was so confused, like, during the whole haircutting process.
Wait, I fade up?
Wait. Okay, first line. No, first not line. But you know, like, you're in the chair, and I'm just not that guy.
Cut around the crown, sweetheart. Please. Right there. Here you go.
I'm surprised she didn't break out a bowl on me, man.
Put
a bowl on my head and give me one of those cuts. But, you know, she did, like, a flat top. She gave me, like, a 1990 Kid and Play. If anybody knows what that is, I look Yeah, it was pretty terrible.
Fresh Prince of Bel Air. Yeah, that's still on TV.
Oh yeah,
Nick at Night right
exactly.
now.
Exactly. She gave me an old Fresh Prince, man, and I was like, "What is this?" So the next week, which was this week, I'm like, "I need to get this fixed." I go to a guy that has something similar. If you're gonna get a haircut,
get a picture.
Go to a guy that has something similar. You know what I'm saying? Hey, you got the same haircut I want. Can you give me that haircut? Yeah, dude. I cut my own hair. That's impressive. All right, let's do it. You sit in the chair.
Nice.
And then you get what you want. So I'm sitting in the chair, right? And I'm thinking, and I knew you were coming on at this point to the podcast today. And I'm thinking to myself, I didn't think of this. I wouldn't have thought of this if we weren't having you on the podcast. But I noticed that whenever I get a haircut, I don't make eye contact with the barber.
What?
Have you ever fallen asleep while getting a haircut?
Yes. Which I'm
I do that all the time.
I'm comfortable really? Doing that.
Yeah.
But I'm
only comfortable now because it's bald, so they just...
Easy.
Yeah. I can move my head around, and they can't mess it up.
That's easy. Good to go. But I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking to myself, wait a minute. And you know, like, you're in the chair. You're not kind of talking. You're not really talking. And you're getting, like, introspective, right? And I'm thinking to myself, why don't I look at this guy in the eyes? Like whenever he looks at me in the eyes, I look at him, but then I look down. If I'm looking in the mirror at my own haircut, out of like embarrassment, like I didn't want him to feel self-conscious or whatever, or bad, if he looks in the mirror, I look away.
Oh my God.
And I'm thinking to myself,
don't make eye contact.
Wait a minute. I used to fight.
Are you scared?
Why am I scared? I'm thinking to myself, why am I not able to make eye contact? And there's like, I'm like, you know, what do you call it? I'm being introspective. I'm looking at myself, you know, trying to figure it out. And I go, oh, I remember back in the day growing up when you stared at somebody.
It's game time.
It's time to fight.
Yeah.
So you learn when you grow up, some places, I guess in other places, this is not the case. But in some places, you go to school, and if you stare at a guy that you don't know for more than a second...
You got a problem, fool?
Yeah, exactly.
That's immediately...
What's
like
up, partner?
You eyeballing
What's
me?
What's up, partner?
Yeah, why are you eyeballing me?
Sup?
And I realized...
It's good.
Here I am, 34 years old, man. I'm removed, over 20 years removed from that environment, and here I am, still...
I think it's just being cautious about a person with clippers near your face. Like
that's a good point.
I'm gonna look away.
Honestly, dude, slice my ear off. Yeah. Let me
just do your thing.
I'm not eyeballing you, sir. Just keep going,
dude. It's all
you're
smiles.
Doing great.
Look, it's even if they're doing a crappy job, it's all smiles. Very good.
That's fantastic.
Yes.
I love it.
Oh, are you doing my initials on the side of my head? Thank you.
It looks kind of like the Drake cut. I like that. That's good.
Thank you. That's what I was going for.
Yes. How did I know that you would be a great hairstylist? How did I know?
You are now my favorite barber.
Let me give you a tip.
$2.
So I was thinking to myself, man, I was thinking about having you on, and I'm like, man, John knows. John fights. John, you know, he's been in that ring. He understands in that cage, and he understands what the eye contact means. And I'll tell you what, man, across the ring, eye contact galore. Nothing but eye contact.
It's intimidation. It's everything. Eye contact is everything across the ring. It could, honestly, you can win a fight by just staring the guy down and then just seeing him. If he's the first guy to look away, boom, you already know that you got him. But
punk test.
That's there are, like, there I've gone into fights where I've not even looked at a guy and I've just been looking around at the crowd like, man, this is fun. Isn't this fun? And I look over at the other guy and he's just intense, like, I'm gonna crush you, I'm gonna eat you for breakfast, I'm gonna take you home and break you. And you could just see it in his eyes, he wants to kill you. Yeah. And you look over and I look at him and he's just intense. And I not always, but some of the last fights, as I turned pro, I was just like, this is fun. And I would just smile. I'd get the intense look, kind of do the intense look with them, and then just crack a smile. And you'd see them kind of look, almost do the pit ball, yeah, or pit bull look where their head goes sideways.
Go cockeyed on.
Yeah, and I'm like, huh?
See, and
are you just smiling?
See, and then, and I'll tell you why I think that's fantastic, because that's your personality.
Yeah.
You're not trying to pretend to be like some kind of badass, like, I'm gonna crush you. Like, that's just not your attitude.
Yeah, no, I've tried to do the badass thing. I'm like, I'm gonna eat him. I'm just gonna crush him. I can't do it.
We all have. Now, for me, it's not. For me, I never felt comfortable, like, you know, like extreme eyes, like, I never felt comfortable. But what I would do is I would just be like intense in a quiet, almost like a Fedor. Like, I always loved the way Fedor would look at a guy, but he wouldn't, like, it was no emotion.
Yeah.
None.
I compare him to, like, if I had to care for people out there that don't know, if you had to compare him to another athlete, for the older folks, it'd be Jim Brown.
Yeah.
Where he just runs, he gets up very gingerly, slowly, and kind of jogs back to the huddle. But every time he runs, it's bang, just bang, bang. It's hard.
Just a monster.
Same thing with Fedor. Man, every time he goes in, he's same. I don't even think he smiles.
If you guys want to see something exciting, check out Fedor in his prime. That guy,
27-1.
Oh my God! If they could have just figured it out at the UFC and just had him on, and they just couldn't pull the trigger. His people were difficult, I guess.
His people were difficult. UFC's difficult.
Dana,
as you
can difficult.
See, Dana's always difficult.
Yeah.
Just kidding, Dana. Love you. Don't hate my guys.
I got a question. So what's more popular right now? Is it a women's or men's MMA?
It really depends, because you,
like,
get some.
Who do you see more people participating? Like, do you see more women jumping into it, or do you see more men jumping into it?
Definitely more men are jumping into it. It's okay. Harder for the men because there's so many that are trying to get into MMA. So, but for the women, I mean, if you get a couple wins and you're in the over 500, and
this is a smaller pool of people.
Yeah, there's not a bunch of women out there trying to be like the next MMA person. But when you got college wrestlers, retired military, guys who know how to fight and just love that adrenaline rush, or guys who have been training and want to go and fight, I think there's more of the guys who want to fight and go in there and stand and bang just to test themselves and also just to push themselves and because just it's fun than there are females. But when Ronda Rousey was doing her thing, females were killing it. Not so much females, but she was killing it for the female MMA.
Nice.
But then when she...
How's she doing now? You're up on the culture. I'm outside of this culture a little bit. Like,
I mean, I'm kind of out on the culture now. I pay attention to kind of like the bigger people. I don't pay attention to the up-and-comers so much. Like, I'm waiting for this Conor McGregor-Mayweather fight, man. Oh, I'm sitting here pondering, like, twiddling my thumbs.
Professional boxer versus professional MMA?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
If it actually goes down.
Yeah, but in boxing rules.
In boxing rules, so Conor might get knocked out.
Nothing
Conor might get knocked out on this.
You know what Joe Rogan says that I love, though? He's like, yeah, but Conor, we don't know. He might go ballistic and just start leg kicking him and take him down.
Gets rocked and just takes him down into the ground and starts holding him.
Takes one good shot from Mayweather, that, you know? Because Conor's known for not – I mean, like, he's got a chin on him.
He does.
He doesn't just
If you knocked it a few times, then it gets tested, and you're like, he turns into a wrestler, as Diaz, yeah, right, as exactly. Diaz says. He turns into a wrestler, but you got to hit him first. It's not easy to hit him. Mm-mm. He moves really, really well.
Really, yeah. And he's tricky, and he's got the spacing down, too.
Yeah.
His spacing is, like, perfection. And you think that he's, like, you know, here.
Yeah.
And then the next thing you know, he's here.
He knows exactly. Like, he doesn't know exactly, but he's good judge at spacing and timing.
Which is why I think that, and that's the only reason, like, if he didn't have that, if he didn't have that plus a pretty good chin, I don't know. I'd be like, now Mayweather. Mayweather's going to win. But Mayweather's 40-something years old. He's got that.
Ooh, that brings me to like my favorite question.
What's your
favorite
question?
You guys are both fight heads, so I could ask this question.
What time is it to retire?
You ever been called a fight head before?
No.
That's awesome. You guys know fighters.
That's a new... Okay, somebody right now is...
I just coined a word?
Fightheads.com right now.
Yeah, seriously. No, so... Anybody in history, best fight at their prime, who would you put up against each other for like the best fight?
Tyson, Bruce Lee.
That I would want to see?
Yeah.
And their prime? Oh, man.
Tyson, Bruce Lee. Tyson.
Oh, my gosh. Tyson?
Tyson versus Bruce Lee? Yeah. Really?
You
Tyson.
You see kind of that kind of fight with him against Jet Li.
Tyson. Yeah, no, that's what got me excited. Tyson, Bruce Lee, but MMA fight.
Oh, so it's pretty much no holds barred.
No holds barred. No, but UFC 1993
rules.
So really no holds barred.
Tyson's a street fighter, man. Hey, he bites people's face off.
That's why.
If you're going 1993, like, he could win that. He's going to bite somebody. He could bite somebody's face off and come out on top.
Yeah, he took two bites out of Holyfield.
Look, so. No gloves. Head kicks on the ground.
I'd have to go at least taping the hands. I can't do no gloves. Like, you gotta go Kumite style. Just tape the hands up. We'll go that way. Tape the hands up, and then it's MMA rules. No groin shots, no eye gouging, no fish hooking.
No
fight.
Fight.
All
right.
But if I had to choose.
Yeah, give me your best matchup throughout all history.
Oh, man, throughout all history.
That's such a hard one, man.
That is.
That's so difficult.
And it's upsetting because. In my head, Bruce Lee wins every fight. Bruce Lee wins. If he has the training camp, that guy is winning everybody who doesn't matter size or weight
Bruce
or who
Lee,
he's fighting.
Bruce Lee was the first mixed martial artist.
Yeah.
I mean, like,
you give him 8 weeks to prepare for somebody, he's going to fight. So he's going to come in and win.
That guy, they credit Bruce Lee with the new cardio movement. Mixed martial arts, because with Jeet Kune Do, that's what he was trying to do.
It was in his movie. We're freaking Enter the Dragon. He's got the MMA gloves.
Yeah,
and
he's got the MMA gloves.
He's got the MMA gloves, and they're sparring. They're doing MMA right there. Mm-hmm. But if I had, like, I would just say...
Who are your two favorite fighters that you'd like to see fight? That's what
Bruce Lee and Roy Jones Jr., but I wouldn't want to see them fight each other. Roy Jones doesn't stand a chance.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I mean, in his prime, he's fast and he's got boxing, but Bruce Lee's got kicks and he's taking any boxer out, no problem.
I'm telling you what, man. Bruce got that one-inch punch that people look at that and they go, oh, whatever. Feel that one-inch punch. Feel it from somebody who knows. Danny Inosanto, feel it from somebody who knows actually what they're doing with that thing, generating that much power and that little bit of space. Now, if Bruce can do that to you when you're, you know, imagine him doing that when he's in your guard.
Oh, crap.
Now, I know.
One inch punch to the chest,
man. Punch right through your chest. Okay, I'm being a little magical right now, okay? I understand.
Cracked he doesn't, a couple ribs.
He doesn't have the hip. Shoot. He doesn't have the hip movement for that or whatever. But
even still, he could. Even if it's not the one inch punch, he can still post his hand up and do the elbow.
Oh, my God.
And if he can generate that much power with the hips and everything with the punch,
yeah.
Imagine if he's just posting up and boom,
Bruce
crack
Lee,
to the ribs.
Bruce Lee was bony, too. I mean, didn't he look bony? He looked strong and bony.
Like ripped out of. He like just ripped
yeah.
at 135.
Yeah. Oh my god.
135.
Could you imagine if he dropped down to 125 and was in the flyweight division?
Fights Demetrius. He'd take out Cruz, he'd take out Garbrandt, and then go down to 25 and go take out Demetrius Johnson, whoever else wanted some.
Are you excited about Garbrandt?
I am a little bit.
Me too, because he really worked.
He beat Cruz at
Cruz
his own game.
So bad. Like, so bad.
He said, Cruz is head. He plays all head games. He comes in, he beats you with the head, and then he's just like, all right, now that I got you angry, I'm going to pick you apart.
Oh,
Garbrandt was like, go ahead, try it. yeah. and came in and did the same thing.
And better.
And even better.
And dude, let me tell you something. Half of the dance moves that he did were legit. If it was just a dance contest, he would have won. Those were some sweet moves, man.
Ridiculousness.
Oh, my gosh. So,
I'm excited for him.
What do you think about... You think Ronda's done?
Yes, because she's stubborn. She won't go to her other... She won't go to any other stand-up coach.
Come on, man.
You know she won't. Even Travis Brown was like, look, this ain't working out. I'm going somewhere else.
It's about time.
Yeah. They're still dating. They're still doing their thing. But he's like, yeah, I'm not training with that guy.
All right, let me explain it to Eric. So,
yeah, I'm out of the loop on this one.
Sorry. I'll explain it to Eric and some people out there. No, this is good, though. So there's a guy named Edward Tarverian, and he is got to be like the used car salesman of coaches in mixed martial arts. This guy has no street cred, lucked up with Ronda Rousey being in his camp.
Oh.
Has held on to her for some reason, even though...
Get her under contract or something?
No. She mind power.
She's wow. just she, when she was winning, she's been trained by him. So when she was on her undefeated streak and was I'm the champ of the UFC, blah blah blah, I'm the face of the UFC, he was in the corner. But she won by intimidation. Like she literally won the fights before she ever got in there and would break these girls down. Other than Misha Tate, Misha Tate was the only girl you're not gonna make me step down. Not gonna make me back up and step down. I'm gonna come and I'm gonna bring the fight to you.
And her judo though, her judo is world class judo. She's able to. She was using judo, and no other fighter, I would say, no other fighter in the UFC, let alone female fighter, has the type of skills that she has in judo.
Okay,
and you know judo. Throws and right to the arm bar. She's like an arm bar master. She can get you in an arm bar virtually from any position, and that's what she would do. Her game plan for her first five fights was get her opponent in an arm bar as quick as possible, submit them.
Get the hands on you.
Get the tap out.
Judo flip you. Get the arm bar.
Get the arm bar. That was her game plan.
There's a meme somewhere of her like hanging wall arms on the wall, and it's like got her people like she beat, and Misha Tate's up there twice. She got both arms.
Yeah, she did. I mean, she's breaking arms. So, but then this guy Edward Tarverian. I mean, there's just this DB of a human being. This guy has got her all hyped up, thinking
she's unstoppable.
Not only that, but a boxer, and she has no stand-up chops whatsoever.
The problem is she knocked somebody out. She knocked somebody out within 12 seconds of one of her fights, and now she's like, oh, well, you know, we boxed, and I knocked this chick out, so my hands dude is he's awesome. He knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
But she only has one move, and it's come in with the lead hook, and the lead hook is to either land or you're coming in to grab the back of their head to get them for a judo toss into an arm bar.
Right.
When that doesn't land, or when somebody hits a 1-2 before they know that's coming, like...
Was she just panicked?
Like Holly Holm.
Dude.
You get pieced up. Like Amanda Nunes, you get pieced up. Especially nasty. When they know what they're doing, and they nasty. Know more than just the 1-2.
Nasty. Nice. I mean, it's the difference between somebody who, like, knows... Okay, you know how there's guys out there, like, you know, at the bar or something, and they're like... Man, I can street fight, no problem. If I get into trouble, I'll be okay. But they're laying all their hopes on is maybe. You know what I mean? Like, there's no training behind it. It's just if I get mad enough. There's an old game we used to play, right? How mad would you have to beat Mike Tyson? That's an old game we used to play. Like, how mad? What would Mike Tyson have to do to your mom, basically? To make you mad enough to beat Mike Tyson.
For the record, there's no madness.
There's no madness. There's no level. Yeah. If you're not trained to his level, there's no amount of mad.
To just right there start fighting.
There's no rage. There's no rage level. You're not going Super Saiyan. You're not going to be able to knock or even hurt Mike Tyson. So, like, that's the...
I have to hit him with a car.
I was gonna say like sniper rifle.
Sniper rifle
at a distance.
So Ronda Rousey.
Bullets stop boxers.
Very well. Ronda Rousey was like that guy at the bar.
Oh, and she just she overestimated like, her ability.
Yeah, and everybody, even Joe Rogan was like saying, oh man, she could probably beat Floyd Mayweather. She's so
what?
Great. Yeah, because she was on a high. Like she was unstoppable. And the hype was going and all that. And that hype mill starts
rolling.
That hype train starts rolling and it can't stop it. And you got guys, very smart guys like Joe Rogan saying, oh man, she's. And he's since been like, okay, I was completely wrong. I didn't.
I got caught up in the hype train.
I got caught up in the hype train.
Nice.
So
I wasn't thinking clearly. So she's hot.
So she fights this other fighter, Holly Holm. And Holly Holm is a 19-time world boxing champion.
Nice.
Not just boxing.
And
kickboxing champion.
Is she Olympic?
Don't think
might
so.
Might as well be. I mean, come on.
But she in her kickboxing career, she had 39 pro fights. That's just pro.
Gosh.
And usually when you're going kickboxing, you have many, almost double
that's like Chuck
amateur
Norris
fights.
Stuff.
Yeah, as so, before you go in. She was like 39-2, and then she was like, hey, you know, I'll just try out the UFC.
Let's see what's over here. Let me just do that. Ronda
has one move against her, and it's mediocre. You think she's gonna win?
No.
That's her move.
That what he just said. That left hook.
That left hook.
Oh no! Hell no! Not against a kickboxer.
And it wasn't even a good left hook. It wasn't. She doesn't fake. She doesn't no head movement. Nothing. Just
wait,
straight.
She's fighting a kickboxer, right? So they obviously know how to take a hit.
And now. Just to preface this, like...
I mean, I don't know a lot about fighting.
There's
but.
The same argument with Roy Jones and Tyson. Like, it's the people that they're fighting. You know, they weren't as good or they were just kind of sloppy. And, like, no, this is what the women's MMA had to offer at this time, which was the elite of the elite of women's MMA. Sarah McCann, she's a wrestler. She was, I think, silver medalist in Olympic wrestling. Women's division. There's other chicks in there. There are boxers that have done kickboxing as well. She wrecked a lot of those people, and she ran through them. But there's people that are adapted. Holly Holm came in and was like, I got my stand-up. Let me just practice not getting in an armbar, not getting tossed. Let me practice not, like, staying at a distance and not fighting her closely. Then she wrecked her, like, knocked her out, made her look dumb. Then Amanda Nunes, she even said it in her interview. She was like, it's my time. I've been training to fight and beat Ronda Rousey since I started in MMA.
Nice.
Like, and
that was her goal. Like,
that,
I
like,
want
to
fight her.
I know I'm going to have to beat Ronda Rousey to come in here and be the champion. And she came in, beat Holly Holm, or beat Misha Tate, who was like one of her coaches, and then went to Ronda Rousey next and made her look a fool. Like, duck Ronda Rousey.
Yeah, I saw that fight. That was a quick fight.
Hilariously fast fight. But
and a lot of people had Ronda winning that
Amanda
fight.
Amanda Nunes got no press. UFC
that's
gave
too
her,
bad.
Gave she was the champion.
She's got nothing.
She was the champion. How are you not if Mike Tyson is the champion but you don't do any press on him because his opponent is Steven Seagal? Mm-hmm. Does that make any sense? No.
All the press on Steven Seagal, like, how do you feel coming into this fight, coming back? And Tyson sitting on the side, like, what about me?
What about me? I'm the champion.
Nah, what about me?
What about me? So then you see
just
what...
Just kidding, Tyson. We love you.
Yeah, please don't punch me in the face.
And screw Tyson. Tyson, come see me.
Nope.
That would be very honorable, though.
I'm
I would
taking
take it like
down.
A champ.
I'm going
more
immediately for Tyson. I'm going immediately to the ground. We're going to the ground, and I'm checking him out.
I'm just gonna curl up and cry.
That was like the whole. That was the whole end of his career. Was just a bunch of guys not end. That was the whole middle of his career. Just guys like getting hit once and falling down.
Nope.
Just
boom, boom. They'd come in like, man, I really. How much am I getting paid for this? All right, I'll let him hit me. All right, I'm down. I'm down.
Yeah, that's what it was. It was a bunch of dudes that were like, I will take. This hundreds of thousands of dollars to get hit. But actually, I wonder how much they were getting paid back then per fight, because it's nowhere near what Mayweather's getting paid.
How much their managers are getting paid.
Yeah. Don King, forget about it.
Everybody was about getting some money. Here, sign here. Sign here. Yeah, no, just go fight this guy, man. You go out there and win, we're going to get a lot more money. A lot more.
We're going to be good.
Just keep winning, man.
Just keep doing what you do. So while Eric is doing a pee-pee break, I'm going to go ahead and see what we've got on the Let's see. Elise says, so I got to say, you lost me at Chappelle. You thought this comedy, his com, wait.
You his thought, comedy wasn't as good?
You thought his comedy and social commentary was top. Oh, she thought his commentary and social commentary and comedy was on point. He humanized his own experience away too. Loved how he explained he wasn't booed off the stage. He was, hold on. He was just booed. Yeah. I'll give you that. At least this is what I was saying. All right. It wasn't killing him softly. It didn't make me like belly laugh like I'm used to. I love Dave Chappelle. I'm happy for him 100%. I think what he's doing is right. He lives out there in Connecticut or whatever. He's living his life. He's got a zillion dollars. He's back in comedy. I'm excited about that. And we just realized he's not going to be the same guy. You know, did you? Okay, so maybe you didn't see him, but you know, he was jacked for a while. The guy looked like he was on roids for a while.
Dave Chappelle.
Dave Chappelle looked like the next heavyweight champion of the world. I mean, the guy was. Well, you got some.
I think I broke it.
Oh, you broke it? I guarantee you didn't break that. No way. Is it not staying in place? Let me turn you down. Oh my gosh. Wow.
Mic check. Mic check. There
we
go.
Mic check. We squealed a little bit.
Oh, we had an slight adjustment.
Sorry about that, everybody is listening. Holy crap. It's a lot louder. Why is it so loud? It's a lot louder.
Live in stereo.
We almost killed ourselves. All right, so what the heck was that? Oh, he looked like the heavyweight champion of the world, Dave Chappelle. And then he got fat. He's a little fat. He's a little soft now. And it's about time. 40-something years old, 45 or something. I don't know how old he is. But you know what?
He's got a family now.
He's got a family. He's got two kids, I think, or three, something like that. The dude is just living life. He's out in Connecticut. He's got his mansion. He's got his farmhouse and his 80 acres or whatever.
Back in his old town where he grew up and where he lived.
No, he's from D.C.
Yeah, but it's somewhere out in Maryland.
No, he's out in Connecticut.
Oh, he's out in Connecticut right now?
Connecticut, yeah. I thought,
you might be right. I just remember seeing him on, like, that one. He had some, like, addressing the people in a town hall meeting.
Yeah.
I saw that on Facebook not too long ago. Town hall meeting, like, when I grew up here, and this officer, this, and he helped me out, and all these officers have helped me out since I've been here. Y'all know the situation. Mm. And he just said, let's be smart about who we put in office, that we are the next sheriff that we put in, make sure that we keep the culture. And
oh, wow, he cares.
Yeah, that we keep the culture that is here and that everybody's still, you know, together how we're supposed to be. Squeaky squeak, squeaky to squeak.
My bad.
Let's bring you down a little bit. Man, I don't know what
bring
happened.
Me down?
Get you some WD-40 for these hinges.
They're brand spanking, too.
That was loud in there. I was like,
Righteous Anger Podcast. I never did that, so there it is. All right, so all right, I had a couple more questions for you.
Shoot, I got questions for you guys.
Oh,
shoot.
Well, shoot. Well, go ahead.
Yeah. All right. So the atheist thing.
Oh boy!
Yeah, I love it, dude. I want to go down all this path.
I can't speak for any other atheists.
No, absolutely. Just only you and only you on your atheist beliefs. I just want to hear what your whole like. Were you always atheist or no?
No. I was raised in a Pentecostal church.
Okay.
Upstate New York, and
that's like super Mexican, by the way.
Super
Hispanic,
super Latino,
because my Colombian people that raised me also were Pentecostal.
Pentecostals, women don't wear pants.
Oh yeah, I've been to some of them before.
They're the ones who are like, they're like a gospel church from the south. But
Gloria
like,
a Dios, Gloria a Dios.
Falling down, screaming, hollering, all that jazz. I was terrified of it.
Like
as
Baptist,
a kid.
Except Spanish.
Basically, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I got you.
Yeah.
And I'm with
I was
you.
Baptized as a Baptist for a little while. I spent time with Jehovah's Witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
As I got older, I lost my mic.
Hold on a second. Wait. We got.
Uh-oh. Lost the mic.
We gotta wait a minute because for some reason.
You got feedback?
I don't know what's going on. All right, time out, everybody. Time out.
Pause. Whoa, my voice sounds cool.
Mic check.
You need
one,
like a filter
two,
pedal.
One,
that'd be neat.
What is going on today?
Levels. Too loud.
Would you stop that, Eric?
You're gonna have to cut this bit.
Eric, you're making this all unusable.
It'll be like a moil.
We're just gonna use this. This will be the outtakes.
People on Facebook are like, what is wrong with these guys?
These guys are straight wild now. All right, test 1, 2.
How's our levels? Are we?
Mic check.
Give me some stuff.
So from there, well, the low end is a little bit. Okay, there you go. Balance the levels.
All right, try it out.
How's the levels doing?
They're low for some reason.
You got the low register all up. Why is the low register all up?
Try that.
So for a while,
Now you sound like a 14-year-old.
You
sound like your balls haven't dropped yet.
Yippee! So this girl talked to me in school today.
Never happened.
She's from Canada. You wouldn't know her. She goes to a different school.
It's my favorite story as a kid.
Oh, he's pressing buttons, folks.
Clickety click click.
Clickety clack.
Real. These levels suck. Hello.
What did you do to the board, brah?
I don't know. I don't know.
See, look what happened. You went to the bathroom and come back and you messed it all up.
Should
have just stayed here. Should have just went in your pants.
Just hold it.
Everything would have been all right.
Could you imagine? It smells pissy in here.
It smells like
it's cool. Our mics are good, though.
Yeah, our mics are good, but it smells bad. Hey, you know what? The audience cannot smell what we smell.
What would you call that? Like smell-o-vision? A smell cast. Oh, man.
Smell cast.
There's no such thing as a smell cast. We could pioneer it.
He's wacky.
A smell cast. That'd be terrible.
you know what? Let's just so on here it looks good. On there it doesn't look good.
Still not
good.
Getting the high register enough. It's leveling off.
What do you mean I'm not getting the high
register?
Look
at the high register. It's topped out.
Yeah. All right. Let me do that. Is that
from
better?
Spinning.
There. Now it's a little bit more leveled off.
It's just my voice that's low, not yours.
Mine's all like whatever. So the story, where were we? Jehovah's Witness. I was Jehovah's Witness for a while. Joined the army. For a while there, I was going to another church in Arizona because we moved from New York to Arizona, and joined the army, started reading, and I decided I guess I'm more of a deist than an atheist.
Okay.
Because I still believed in God. I thought, you know, well, there's probably this grand creator who probably set everything in motion and then just walked away from it and said, I'm going to see how
this
works out. Yeah, I did a good job. I'm going to take a break. I'm going to go smoke some weed.
Smoke some weed, come back and see how this looks.
So then I started reading more about...
While you guys are talking.
There was a wave of books coming out. Sam Harris's book, Daniel Dennett's, Christopher Hitchens. I'm missing somebody important.
Sam Harris is always on Joe Rogan's podcast, like always.
Sam Harris is awesome. I wonder how he can afford him. That dude like usually starts at like 100K.
Probably good friends. And just say, hey, come on. Come on here and
yeah, lots of visibility, that's for sure.
To these million people that listen to me for no reason.
Oh, Dawkins. Dawkins is the other one. Richard Dawkins.
Hear me talk.
So started reading those books and I was like, okay, well, I guess that's it.
Nice.
Yeah. Like there's not enough evidence, and the evidence that the claims in the Bible are wrong, there's just far too many of them. So
yeah.
I disagree with that.
Well, there's a lot of claims in the
Which
Bible that are
like,
metaphors and allegory and stuff like that. And I was like, well, I don't want to believe in fairy tales anymore.
Which is also like another one of my questions. How does this even work with like...
We're not assholes to each other.
Yeah, that's what we're trying to show is like...
it can work, right?
And a Christian can get along and be cool. They can have a beer. Yeah.
And be happy and merry. It's a lot what gets missed in today's world.
For sure.
Well, yeah. I didn't even.
We don't
think
have to be antagonistic to each other. Is the main thing we're trying to show is like, yeah, it'd be cool.
I didn't even think of that.
What
our show is showing people how to coexist, man. Look at my bumper sticker.
Just for real, like, hey,
or
man,
try to.
You're an atheist. Cool. I'm a Christian. Let's have a beer. Let's have a discussion. Sweet, awesome. That was a great beer. Let's do this same time again next week.
Pretty much.
I mean, that's all it has to be. Instead, it's like, you're an atheist. Oh, my gosh, I should burn you.
What's wrong with you? That is a point of contention among atheists. I'm going to just point it out. It's a little bit of a historical sticking point for me, how atheists have been, like, hunted and burned and murdered, and, like, nobody cares.
You don't believe in God? You're a witch. You're a witch.
Like, nobody weeps for an atheist that gets burned at the stake. They're just
Jesus,
like, eh, whatever.
Jesus, he wept.
I hope he did.
Jesus cared, and his followers that were crappy followers that still exist today,
yeah,
who snitched,
are the ones who you're mad at.
Well, on. Yeah.
He's not mad at me because I'm not a bad Christian.
Oh, we got a question from a fan. Could we? Could you ever marry an atheist, and could I ever marry a Christian? And Leo's going to throw out the argument of the
equally
yoked.
I could marry someone who was not who is an atheist, but I know that unless they become a Christian, it's gonna end up not working out because of the existential issue. And anybody who says that there's not an existential issue is only fooling themselves, because at some point you're gonna be questioning, you're gonna have these questions, and if you guys don't have the same answer, that's the biggest question you can have. You everything else falls apart if you guys are not on the same place there.
I would agree with that up to a point, because I've seen people who are like very devout Christian, not a very devout, you know, anything else. Like, they're just whatever. They don't believe in God. They don't believe in anything like that. And they've been together for 40 years or longer in some cases. And very happy, you know, well-adjusted folks. It's just, it can be done. It's just not easy. You have to actually take time to work through the issues that Leo's talking about.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but the hard part of that, though, is if you are a Christian. And now, you don't have this as an atheist, obviously, because you believe that no matter what, when you die, and no big deal, right? But as a Christian, you're like, man, my wife or my husband is not, quote unquote, saved. Right, so they're not gonna end up, you know, being with me in paradise. You know what I mean? If you believe in that,
I do have fire insurance. I have been baptized as a Baptist. I have the baptismal certificate and everything.
I've been baptized twice.
That's the beautiful twice.
Twice. I was a kid the first time.
Oh,
okay. And I was a teenager. Like, I was three. I was like four or five. Like, I remember it, and then. But I didn't really know what was going on. I was like, sweet, we're getting in the pool.
Yeah, it doesn't count. Because to me, it's a heart issue. Like, if you don't honestly believe and you were baptized, this whole fire insurance thing, it's like, it's the same thing as legalism.
Oh,
like,
I believed when I got baptized.
That's why, but you don't now. So I'm saying, it does matter. What I'm saying is that if you believe in legalism, then yeah, you're okay. I don't believe in legalism. I believe in an actual relationship, you know? And if you are like, I don't want to have anything to do with God, well, then you'll get what you want.
Yeah.
Maybe.
It comes down to what you believe. Like, if you believe that the end is the end,
yeah,
then that's it. But if you don't, and you're with somebody who doesn't believe that the end is the end, then sure.
See, I've done too many extracurricular activities to believe that the end is just the end.
You've had near-death experiences.
You wanted to say poisoning yourself with cow poop mushrooms?
Nice
near-death experiences. Then yeah, absolutely. I've had quite a few of those.
Psilocybin mushrooms.
Some with chocolate.
See, I know I brought you on for a reason. Please do tell me about that.
Oh man. Well, first off, I'm not Christian or atheist. I honestly have no idea what's going on out there. I don't know
That's
anything.
Honest.
Like, I'm as far as I know, in my mind, from what I've heard and not just what I've studied, because I don't do a lot of studying. I just go
you
off.
You should.
I do some, but like I'll check it out. I'm like, hey, this person said this. Let me go check it out. But I do believe there's an afterlife. Hmm. What it is, I have no idea. I don't think we're just done and done. Like me and my one other buddy believe that the conscience is a separate being in itself, and once the body, this body is done, that it goes on somewhere else. But like I said, I've done a lot of extracurricular activities to be
are you saying extracurricular activities because you feel like you don't, what do you mean by that? Like, what is the problem with doing extracurricular activities? What are you saying?
I've done shrooms. I've done shrooms.
So what does that mean?
I've done acid. I've read some things and heard some things. I have DMT.
Yeah, NMDMT, right?
I'm waiting to do that. I haven't done it yet.
I got a chemist friend who made an alkaline version of that drug. You can actually just eat it naturally. You don't need a MAOI.
Smoke it or anything.
You don't need to smoke it. You don't need to do anything crazy with it. You just eat it.
What?
It's
I may need to get into contact with your friend.
No. You don't know anything about that. Come on.
I don't. I don't know anything.
You don't
about
want anything
that.
To do with this friend, right?
Not at all.
Right. Yeah.
Not at all.
Talking about
stuff. I just want to say hello and give him a wave.
Yeah.
But either way, no. There's just like I grew up in a Christian household. My dad's a pastor now. My mom follows Christian faith a lot, and just. Like, I was super hardcore Bible all in teenage years, but I was like, hey, man, let me see what all this alcohol and other stuff is about. And to be honest, I did shrooms before I even, like, drank alcohol or smoked weed. And,
that's hardcore.
And that was an eye-opening experience.
Tell me about that. Tell me about that story. Like, how did you get the shrooms?
So there's this kid in high school, my buddy Shane. And I had just moved to Ashburn. I lived in Sterling for a year. I was a freshman in Sterling, going in Pot Falls, and moved to Ashburn when my dad got married, and ended up going to Broad Run. And I go to Broad Run, and this kid named Shane is like, "Yo, man, what's up?" Start hanging out with him and this other buddy named Garrett. And before I knew it, they had talked about smoking weed before, and I had never done it. But at this point, I had one sip of beer and I thought it was the grossest thing in the world. But then they were like, "Yo, I got these shrooms." And I was like, "Man, it's high school. I'm trying to be cool.
You try shrooms.
I don't want to do, I want like, screw it. Let's see what this is all about. What better time than now?" And next thing I know, I'm traveling the world to Ashburn Village, and I'm in Subway just laughing at every single person that walks in, because they're walking in normally, but to me, they're walking in and they're like their whole body, like they're doing the worm walking in, just and they got all these funny colors around them. They got this glowing rainbow around them, and I'm just looking at them as they walk in, and they're looking at me like, "Oh my gosh, what is wrong with them?"
What
and
is
I'm
this drooling moron doing?
Yeah, and I'm looking at them like, "Oh, you're the craziest thing I've seen." No, now you are. but it was
sounds like an experience.
It was quite an eventful experience. I remember specifically going to my friend's house, because I knew I wasn't done yet, and things were still looking weird. And I went to my friend's house, where there's like a different group of friends. There's like the thug hanging out druggy friends, and then there's like the cool, not really cool, but like the hangout friends that were not doing shady things yet and were just like hanging out and having fun. And I went to go hang out with them, and I remember coming down the stairs and seeing everybody, and my one buddy Stuart comes up to me, and he had the bushiest eyebrows. I remember specifically
shut up about bushy eyebrows.
No. These like you got bushy eyebrows, but these, at this point in time, I walked down and he came up, "What's up, man?" And I remember just being like, "Whoa." And his eyebrow and forehead just going like lunging out towards me. And that was probably the craziest thing I've seen. And that was that, like the tail end of it. And I started to come down and things were going back to normal. But man.
So that shaded your opinion of what? How did that
shade? No, that was just fun.
Oh, okay.
The shading of the opinion was when We did, me, my buddy Carl, and my buddy Barrett went to a beach house. And I hope they're here on Facebook listening now because it's going to be fun. But we went to my buddy Carl's beach house, and we all ended up doing shrooms after our beach week. And I turned into a wolf. Not physically, obviously, but like we were in the living room trying to smoke weed to calm ourselves down and bring us back to like normal life and keep our nerves like, but the whole time we're like on the way up to our peak. And so as I'm going, I just get up and I'm like, guys, I got to go for a run. And they're like, what? We're at the height of our peak where things are like walls are starting to move. We're listening to the doors.
The doors?
Yeah, we're listening to the doors to get like the surreal experience.
Oh my gosh, do you remember what song? Can you sing it?
Oh, I couldn't even tell you what song. Everything sounded like gibberish to me.
Oh man, but I hope it was the end.
Everything was gibberish. This is the end. We had the doors playing, but we had the Family Guy on TV with no sound, so it was even weirder.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, you missed the bus on Rick and Morty, dude.
I saw part of it. Like a few episodes. But I've really been on like South Park and what's the action figure one? Robot Chicken.
Oh.
Love Robot Chicken.
Is that what you do when you're high?
Oh, yeah.
Usually? Oh, okay.
Cartoons?
All right. Day, every day.
All right.
It's a harmless drug.
Either that or listen to Joe Rogan. But
I can imagine you going, listen, look, I've never done drugs.
Yeah. Really? Never?
Yeah, never.
Ever.
People are surprised. I've never done drugs. And
not even weed.
You're
not
an
even
artist. Weed. You're supposed to.
I know, right? And
that's flabbergasting.
I know, right? Like I'm new.
You're an artist and a fighter, and you've never done drugs.
I'm a new guy. I'm a new one. You've never seen me, but
wow.
But I watch Joe. I listen to Joe Rogan, and I get paranoid just listening to it sober. I couldn't imagine like being on a high and just being like.
He's all about the DMT.
Yes.
He loves it. Yeah, he probably does that like every week.
I always wanted.
Saturday,
like,
it's not for my DMT trip.
Every
right?
day. Not
every day?
Not every
wow,
week.
That
every
is,
day.
That's impressive.
No, if you watch, he does his podcast every single day. True or false? Every day he does a podcast.
No, I meant the DMT.
About 34 days of the podcast, yeah.
Right. And
no, I mean, he
if he's
DMT
not on somebody else's.
Once a week.
Why?
Because.
His DM.
He talks about it all the time.
Oh, he loves
well,
it.
Well, I'm saying he does that stuff every time because, like, they're high
dang.
Doing the podcast.
That's a nice life.
They've been on there and, like, here, you want to hit this?
Yeah,
like,
hey.
Passing the joint.
Here. Oh, hey, try this edible and, like, just.
I'm going to have to put him in touch with my chemist friend. That'd be pretty great. Here, try this. It's
oh
a more
gosh.
Potent version of DMT.
Oh, my gosh.
The trip lasts longer and it doesn't feel scary.
Jeez Louise. Don't worry, everybody. We're going to stick to hookah.
Yeah.
All right.
We're going to be on
this
the hookah
is a,
while we're
this
here.
Is a, this is a family friendly.
Leo's face is melting while he says that.
Only in your eyes, right? Only in his eyes.
What?
Dude.
Your eyebrows just got a way more
whoa,
bushy.
Man. They look like the caterpillar from Alice in Wonderland.
True story.
So.
Well, no. So.
That was.
So I tell these guys, I'm like, hey, I got to run. And mind you, we're like a block and a half from the beach. And they're like, what do you mean? Like, they're tripping balls, too. They're like, what do you mean you got to run? We all got to stick together, man. You can't just go off running. What if we lose you? And I'm like, guys, it'll be okay. I just got to run. And I, like, take off my shirt, get down to my gym shorts, and I'm like, I'm out. I kid you not. I'm running out on a golf course. That's where the condo is, on a golf course. And at one point, I was just jogging like a sprint on 2 feet. And I got down on all fours and just started all fours running and was
that's awesome.
Doing it. Just
you
like,
gorilla
dude,
ran.
Dude, I'm kidding. I didn't even think about it till the next day. I'm like, man, if people, it wasn't that late. It's like 10 o'clock, 11
John,
o'clock.
This dude seriously turned into a werewolf.
Like, oh. Exactly. Like, people are,
did you howl?
Where?
I just
got to
hear that you howled.
Oh, my God.
Did you howl?
He probably did.
I did on
times.
The way home.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Oh my gosh, dude!
But I'm
you
like
were in touch with you were in touch with a primal part of your mind, man.
Even more so that I got lost, and I don't know how, but somehow, some way, I got lost, and I looked up, and I was like, "It's cool. I'm gonna use the stars to get home." And I got home. I got home, and like 45 minutes later, I come in the door, and like, dude, where you been? And I'm like. I don't even know. And we sat back down, and they were like, oh, my God, dude.
You need a better trip sitter, my friend.
This guy,
you need a trip sitter who's going to be sitting on you.
A trip sitter. This guy freaking turned into, like, Oh, a sailor from the 1800s.
None of my 1700
sailor. I'm going to use the North Star. Which one is the North Star?
That's Polaris. I'm going to go that way.
That way.
None of my friends like tripping with me anymore.
Holy crap. Yeah, because you start working out.
I start running and take off. I'm like, I tell them every time, fair warning, man. If I just disappear, don't worry. I'll come back. Don't worry about
eventually.
Me. Eventually.
I might have a dead rabbit in my mouth.
May or may not.
Dead rabbit.
There's another time I climbed the roof and scared all my friends. They made me watch Alice in Wonderland on shrooms, and I was like, dude, you guys are crazy.
Oh,
so I put my face in the couch.
Try to escape the caucus race. You get up on the roof. There's a flood coming. Get up here.
Well, essentially.
There's got to be some like side effects to what you've done, though. Come on.
I mean, I'm sure. Like, I've tried.
You seem very well adjusted.
Molly and ecstasy before. Those are just so crazy, though. Stay away from those kids.
Isn't Molly just ecstasy?
It's pure MDMA, but it's never really pure. Come on.
Yeah, you can't do pure. That's nuts.
If it's you always could. Cut. It's A, kids. Go in the other room. A, it's always cut with something. And B, if you get really, really pure, man, you are about to have the time of your life.
Drink lots of water.
Yeah, drink lots of water and
like
half
a
thing of orange juice.
Nice. You get the vitamin C to prevent the headaches.
Yeah.
Nice.
Dude, I know for a fact.
Get that extra boost.
I know for a fact that I'm too paranoid. Like, if I were to do any of that,
so you got to go on vacation.
Yeah, man.
If I were to do that, man, I know it would just be a bad trip. It wouldn't be good.
You need a good trip sitter, somebody who puts on cartoons,
yeah.
Gets you food.
I've had
keeps,
friends
keeps an eye on you,
but
you know,
I've
like
had bad
you
trips.
Safe.
It's not always fun when you have the bad trip. There's been group tripping where it's like, hey, yeah, everybody's cool. But then there's like group tripping where it's a couple of guys first time and you're like, oh, man, I got to sit with this guy. And we
with this
wait,
guy.
Wait. Let me hear that again. So you guys did group tripping where multiple people were doing their first time?
I believe there's three people were doing it their first time. One guy, it was his bachelor party. That was his bachelor party. He wanted to have oh, good. He wanted to have his bachelor party instead of going to the strip club. He wanted all of us to get together in a hotel room and just trip balls. So my other buddy was like, yeah, no problem, dude. Let's do that.
Drugs or naked chicks?
¿Por qué no los dos?
And four.
Why not have both?
Just,
oh, my gosh.
Oh, I don't know, man.
Then you end up missing a tooth, you know.
I can't handle
Mike Tyson and a tiger in the next room.
I can't handle looking at myself tripping balls, let alone some girl's boobs jiggling around. I mean,
jeez.
Breast jiggling around.
Would that would mess you up? Is that bad?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I don't know.
So if you ever do shrooms, don't look at yourself in the mirror. Don't ever go to the bathroom.
Freak out.
Go outside.
What happens if you do that?
When I look at myself in the mirror, your eyes, everything, your face just goes, wow, and you're just
dude,
like, oh,
I can't handle
no.
You're going to have an identity crisis and be like, is that really me?
Is this
dude,
me?
I'm telling you.
Especially if you go to the bathroom. Do I remember going to the bathroom and just looking at myself like, what is this thing? Why is this thing leaking water out of me right now?
Oh,
what? Like, why do you look like a mushroom?
You're
I'm pretty
asking,
sure I
you're
ate
asking
one
the
of you.
Serious questions. Though. You're really asking questions about yourself that nobody else takes the time to think about. Like,
no, like, what,
why is my nose there?
Like, why is right here? Why
right
can't it be over here?
Yeah.
Why didn't their ears
see,
here and then the nostril
now,
here
now
and the
you,
nostril there?
Now hear me out. You guys were like, oh, you're an artist. I can't believe you haven't done. You know, I have. Those thoughts without the drugs. I look at
imagine the thoughts you'd have with them.
Right.
I look at human beings and
a
I
whole
go,
another level.
I look at human bodies, you know, and I just go, why like that? You know, and then imagine it another way. And then I go, okay, all right. I'm an idiot. That's why not like that. You know,
yeah.
Why not the nose over here? And then this, and then I go and I draw it and I'm like, man, that looks terrible. Never mind.
You got to be brave.
Now,
man.
If I'm on drugs, you know what? I bet you it's the same as alcohol.
You're like, that looks great.
That looks awesome.
Which
this is how humans should look now.
By the way, alcohol is definitely a drug, just for the record.
Definitely.
All you guys listening at home.
Yeah.
It's probably the worst. It's the real gateway drug.
Holier than thou.
I was going to say sugar is, but whatevs.
That too, man.
Caffeine, sugar, same, but different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, type 2 diabetes, man. Nobody wants that.
But, so, I mean, honestly, I went from Christianity, and there's just too many holes. There's too many questions that I wanted answered, and my dad, who is a pastor, could answer some of them, but not all of them. Most of them were like, hey, you need to pray and, like, meditate. And then I started looking into things and started asking more and more questions and essentially just came to the conclusion, like, yeah, maybe there is a higher power. I'm not one to say there is or there isn't. I don't know donkey poop from anything. Like, I'm just Jon Hughes. I'm just the MMA fighter. I get a hit in the head for a living and make sure people don't squat and break their back. But from my perspective and my opinion, I see that maybe we all are connected and there is a higher power. But what the higher power is, I won't know until afterwards. I don't know until after this ride. Maybe not even then. But the more and more I start listening and, like, asking questions, and that's, I mean, the real reason why I keep doing shrooms and want to do the DMT is I got answers, or I want questions that need answers. And I have had some questions answered doing shrooms. And I feel like after doing some research, DMT will answer some as well. But I won't know until I know. And I work 7 days a week. DMT, I feel like, is not something you can just do in the morning and then be like, all right, I'm going to go to work later on this afternoon.
You're going to need to sit down and think about it for a couple hours.
Yeah, I'm
going
to need like a whole 24 hours to sit and marinate on life and what I just witnessed and realized and what answers have been brought to me, and let alone try to remember what answers just got brought to me. But, I mean, I've heard people doing too much DMT and the guys on the other side of DMT saying, hey, you've done too much, don't do this again, it's going to be detrimental, and then they just stop doing DMT. I've also heard of people doing too much shrooms and now half their face is paralyzed. But I mean, I got some things that I want answered, and not a lot of people have been able to answer it to me, so I'm going elsewhere to find my own answers.
I'm
meditation and tapping into the other side.
Two things.
I just want to comment on that.
All right,
do you mind?
Yeah, go ahead.
That's a good answer.
Yeah. And I don't know is a great answer.
Yeah. The I don't know and I have questions and I want answers. Now, the only way we differ for the most part is some of the bigger answers I think I found for myself. Like, is there a higher power? Is there an afterlife? Is there a God? I think I found those answers for myself.
Me too.
You know, like, and I think that's where we both get this mutual respect is I got what satisfies me and he's got what satisfies him. And what was the other thing? Crap. Oh, where you're seeking your answers, right? Like old school gurus, right? Hindu gurus.
Yeah.
They believed in purifying the body or purifying the mind. And
through meditation and like cleansing.
There's also the curiosity where you could explore explanations, I guess is the only way to put it. We call it science now.
Yeah, which is kind of what I've been doing, but I haven't really like.
So you're like threading the needle. You're going through. I want to purify the body, find the answers that are good for me, and I want to explore the science of it at the same time. So that's pretty cool.
My
opinion.
Which brought me to Joe Rogan. Like I always thought he was funny and cool, but then I started listening. I was like, dude, he's saying some real things are going on here, and the people who he's having on are saying some real, real things. I might want to listen a little bit more.
Yeah, I'm interested in Joe Rogan because he does ask those questions. I would say, right when I'm about to say something, why don't you keep smoking?
Okay,
I got next. But
go ahead and vent a little bit. I had a little vent session, rant session.
But I will
get on your soapbox.
I will say that, you know, I was in the same place that you were in, and where you didn't get answers, I felt like I did get answers. It's interesting. Like the very next thing I wanted to ask you was, okay, what were your questions? You know, like what were the questions that you felt like you just didn't get answers to? because, you know, when you ask a question,
yeah,
so much of that depends on where you're standing in the world at that moment, at that point. Where you get your answers from, like from your dad, his answer is going to be usually from where he's standing at that point in life right then and there. You know what I mean?
He's a pastor, so it's going to follow with along his pastor lines what he's teaching and what he's preaching.
So do you remember any of those questions that you had, like that you were struggling with?
The ones you got answers for.
The ones that I had answers for, I mean, I'll start with the ones that I don't have answers for. I don't think, and there might be answers out there right now. It's like, what happened to 33 years of Jesus's life?
Yeah.
Like when he was growing up. Yeah. Like that was a major one for me.
What do you mean?
The Gospel of Mary, man.
Like when he was a kid, when he was a baby, when he was teenagers, mm-hmm. all through high school, I'm like, okay, I hear about Jesus while he was 33 and older.
Mm-hmm.
And how he changed his way, or not changed his ways, but how he preached the gospel and did his thing. What happened through his 20s? What happened when he was a teenager? What happened in high school? I was like, what happened when he was hitting puberty? Is it the same thing that was happening to me?
That's in the Bible.
Did he want to put it in every single girl like I did?
That okay?
Did he
want to
just whip it out and be like, hey,
unless it's
this thing bigger than normal?
So if you, like, so it's actually
are you guys uncut like I am. What's the deal?
It was Jewish. I'm sorry.
It's actually in the Bible, and it talks about when he was a young kid, and it talked about him going into teenagehood. What's that?
The Bible, he goes from 12 to 33. The whole teenage years are gone.
No, that's fine. When he becomes...
It's not fine with me.
Well, hold on. Hold on now. Hold on.
I don't want ganging up on you.
No, you are. No, but,
okay,
but,
I'm not going to gang up on you.
I'm not afraid of ganging up. Now, you got to look at a couple of things. First of all, why you got to ask the question, why did they focus on those years as opposed to teenage years, right? Or like... adolescent, like into his adolescence, and then why did they come right back into the 33? Well, first of all, you got to look at the Bible as what it is, which is a historical account. All right, if you look at it as a historical account, it's not going to have everything in a person's life. It's going to have the most important parts of that person's life. The fact that we have the younger part of his life, where he in the Jewish community, when he becomes a basically goes through his like bar mitzvah, young to... I got to get those things.
Would Jewish consider becoming a man?
Coming a man, right.
Yeah.
Exactly. What they say about Jesus in that historical account is that he was teaching in the synagogues to the teachers. So it's like they looked at this kid like, holy crap.
Who are you?
This kid is a prodigy. And he's like basically giving these guys the business... and they're amazed by him. So that's like the first look that we get at Jesus is that, you know, he is.
This kid's legit.
He
knows his stuff and he knows what he's talking about.
Yeah, exactly. But he's legit to a like almost unhumanly legit. Like with the things that you talked about, like the stuff that we all deal with, like you just said lust, you know what I mean? Like dealing with all the stuff that everybody
lust,
here, that
gluttony,
everybody here that's a teenager,
thievery,
that's ever been a teenager knows.
Anybody here that's listening and that's a man,
knows
that has been to the beach
or even a woman, right?
Or a woman.
So, look at anybody that went through Beyond Strength Performance. So, because you guys are so sexy, right? But
we try, especially that Todd.
I'm definitely not.
No, I'm not sexy either. But so.
It's my beard.
So they look at his life and they go, wow, he was a special kid. Kind of like not normal at all, this kid. Like this kid is not he's a kid, but he's not like how a kid would really be. Like he's a little too mature. He's a little too knowledgeable about God stuff. Why is that? You know, and it started raising questions. Okay.
Just a little smart ass.
Probably
who sent you?
There was probably priests in the synagogue that were like, who's this little like bastard, you know what I mean? And then why do you think the story picks up at
33?
Why do you think then?
Because he was a little head.
He actually
was a
ministry.
Teenager.
So beginning of the ministry.
So hey, I know this stuff.
His first miracle, right? Why would you care about anybody in history? Because they did special things, right? So you're looking at this kid and you're like, well, he is special. He might be the one. You got to realize that throughout this whole time, if you look at Jewish history, they've been waiting for what the Messiah, the one, right? They've been waiting for this person, this God in person, right? That would come down. Okay, maybe this is the kid. Okay, let's annotate that. Let's put that in history. Then fast forward. Now, holy crap. He does something that actually is legitimately can be seen as a miracle. If you saw somebody, all right, I'm saying today, right now, if I take some water and I turn it into something else,
I'd be like, I'm on the carbonara effect.
What's that? What's that?
This is a reality magician TV
oh,
show.
Oh, yeah. David Blaine, right? Like, right. Whoa, wait a minute. So
he's palming some meal.
You're like, you got hidden cams somewhere around here.
So Jesus's life is like not noteworthy. It's not for the history of the ages in the Jewish faith.
Okay.
Until he does something that's worth.
I'm just setting it down.
Okay. Until he does something that's worth writing down, which was that moment. Okay. So if you look at the Bible as what it's supposed to be, which is a history, it's an oral history that's written down. Now it's a written history. You gotta go, well, of course they didn't write all his life down because they didn't even know who he was at that time.
See, they did, though. Because you just got finished telling me that
who did?
At 12 years old, this man was preaching the gospel. So at 12 years old, they were like...
What do you mean preaching the gospel?
Well, not preaching the gospel, but being like, hey, he's wiser than he should be at 12 years old about some religion.
He knew the Torah inside and out.
He's,
at 12.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a special kid. Yeah. Obviously.
So then if you know he's a special kid, you're going to be keeping an eye on
but
him.
But let me ask
like
you a question.
13, 14, all the way up to 30, especially in the 20s.
If you've been waiting hundreds of years for the one,
mm-hmm.
are you just going to look at a kid that's special and go, yeah, he's the one?
Or, no, but I'm going to keep a close eye and be like, hey,
which
let
is,
me
exactly, which
let
is
me
what
make
they,
sure. Cause
which is what they did in the history books. They go, okay, let's write this down. This is kind of special. He does come from an important line. If you look at his line, he comes from King David. He comes from Solomon. He comes from these guys. Like, if you and I look at it right now.
We all come from King David and Solomon and
hear
all
me
these
out.
Guys.
As a history teacher, as a history guy, right? If you look at history, right? You got to place yourself right now.
Why are you giggling over there?
People getting comments about this. They're freaking out.
Oh, I know.
I'm
I know.
Sure they are.
I know. They're.
You talk about religion or politics.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Blow
they're
up.
Not freaking out like bad. They're just like, yeah, he was preaching. There's also gospels that are considered apocrypha that cover the period of life you guys are talking about.
Now,
the Gospel of Mary Magdalene covers his adulthood.
Now you do.
And
now,
I've read it, and it's pretty fascinating stuff.
Now you do realize.
Is that in the Bible?
No, it wasn't. It was considered apocrypha. That's
now exactly. You realize why that is, though.
Because of the Council
Hold on,
of Nicaea.
I
got
to pee before we get into this
do
deeper.
You, now, do you realize why the Council of Nicaea did that?
I probably thought it had no utility.
No, wrong.
Well, why then? Let me hear this.
It's because that they had very strict, not measurements, but very very strict...
textual requirements.
Requirements, yeah. Thank you, for what is quote-unquote God-breathed, and that stuff did not make it in there because it did not. It's the same thing in science. When you look at something, you've got parameters. If it doesn't fit those parameters, you can't include it in the findings. It just doesn't add up.
That's fair.
So if you look at, now, if it was just a bunch of books like you think it is, just a bunch of books that were written by random people and there was nothing to it, well, then I'd be like, yeah, it is a bunch of BS because there was nothing to what they were doing, but there was. They had rules. They had reasons for putting the book together as it was and not. And there was historical reasons why they did it. It had to satisfy historical, like you said, requirements.
There's a lot of politics involved in that also, of the era.
See, that's...
And that's where I'm like, okay, well...
You can say
if
that,
you're
but
a believer, just in the framework of a believer.
Here, let me get that.
Yeah, in the framework of a believer, you got a question like, today you read things like the Warren Report, right, about JFK's assassination, and you got to look at that from the period that it was written and the people who wrote it and why they assembled it the way they did. The Warren Report, as an example, I'm jumping around, but if you were a believer in that there was a conspiracy against JFK's life, you obviously don't buy the Warren Report. But if you do believe that the Warren Report's true, then obviously you accept their findings. So
I need
with the Bible, you have the same kind of paradox. It's like, if you're a believer, you believe that the Council of Nicaea was divinely inspired to assemble the Bible exactly as God intended. But if you're somebody who's kind of open to the idea that humans are fallible and humans make mistakes and humans have political agendas, you can see how, okay, maybe some of these apocrypha were legit.
Now, let me tell you something.
So
let me tell you something.
It's a question of,
do you believe in history?
Of course I do.
Do you believe in the validity of history?
I believe we're in the year 12,000.
No, I mean in the events of history that happened in the past.
History's written by the winners, you know that.
So you're saying you don't believe
in
history?
That's my problem.
Yeah.
So you guys are saying that you can't trust any history that...
A lot of history is pop culture. Like, you want a great example of how pop culture just shades history?
As an archaeologist...
Do you know who Israel Bissell is? Do you have any idea who Israel Bissell is?
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you know who that is?
Yeah, good.
I don't, so I'm excited to hear
this.
Okay,
you probably have heard of Paul Revere, right?
Yeah.
Paul Revere wrote a grand total of like 12 miles to warn of the British attack.
Yeah.
Israel Bissell, he rode like something like 600 miles. He rode from, I think, Boston all the way down to Norfolk.
To warn
of the British invasion. Everyone knows who Paul Revere is, but
he
a very short leg of that warning ride. Israel Bissell did the majority.
How do you know that even happened?
Because there are people who've written about it.
Exactly.
Yes.
So,
and the Apocrypha are things that people wrote about.
So listen, hear me out. So as a person that comes from, again, archaeology, okay, anthropology, you know I'm not just going to come at you with voodoo.
Okay.
Right? There are ways that we are able to look at the Jewish history. We're able to look at the Christian history and we're able to verify it more so than the existence of Julius Caesar. And yet we have no qualms about the existence of Julius Caesar and the things that he's done.
Julius Caesar has his face printed on money.
But
we find that money everywhere, all over Italy.
Okay, but what about all the stories? What about all the... What do? You cross-examine.
You do textual analysis.
This person wrote about this. This person wrote about this. And then our archaeological record...
I grant you that.
Substantiates.
You
talked about money, archaeological record, right?
Yes, it is considered one of
those...
Same
thing happens in the Bible. So now you got to give some credibility to the Bible. Yes, you do. You have to give... Look, talking as an archaeologist, you've got to give the Bible credibility as a document that... is historical.
Okay, I can agree to that, but I cannot admit that the pyramids are evidence of Egyptian gods. Do you understand how that presents a problem?
Right. I get what you're saying. No, I get what you're saying. The leap is not that in the Bible, if it says the Hittites were a tribe and it was a thing, and now we have archaeological proof where we didn't before, and atheists were saying, there's no such thing as Hittites, and this is proof, we've never, and then we find it and it's there. I get that the leap of faith is in the divine, in the metaphysical. I get that. I understand.
Okay.
But what I'm saying is, can you at least go as far as saying that the stuff that's written in there that can be cross-examined with other writings from other cultures is something that we, if we believe in Caesar, if we believe in stuff that happened 600-700 years ago, even 250 years ago, because of cross,
cross-textual analysis.
Cross-textual analysis. Then we can do the same thing for the Bible.
You can't do a degree.
You can't say it's all voodoo.
I'm not an expert, but the people who are textual analysis experts, they run aground. They run out of proof at a certain point.
Which you're supposed to, because now you're talking about the metaphysical. It's the same thing in science.
No, it's fair, but you don't see that problem in other things that we have a little bit more evidence for.
Okay, what God do you have an evidence for?
None. That's why I don't believe in any.
That's what I'm saying. That's the only leap of faith. The Bible is not the problem.
You have evidence of cultural belief in God. You have evidence of cultures that had beliefs in God.
Yes, yes.
Now you have evidence of the culture.
Yes.
And you have evidence of the belief system.
Yes.
Making the leap from the belief system to the tangible belief itself is so far.
That's why it's a leap of faith. I'll say two things. One, as an atheist, you're making as much of a leap of faith because you don't know what happens when we die. You have no clue.
That's a leap of faith that everybody takes, I think.
No, fair.
Yeah.
I'm shaking hands with you on this.
Yeah, yeah.
We're both shaking hands on this.
John's tuned out.
No, I'm in there.
John's in.
I'm in there.
He's got his
I'm just waiting.
He's got his Pusser's rum. He's over there. But what I will say is this.
Yeah,
okay?
Go for it.
Now,
I got one more point when you're done.
Now that we look at the Bible as something that is a historical, done exactly the way that the Jewish, and hell, even the you know, is written in three different languages, but especially the Jewish way of recording history. Okay, it doesn't
it's matrilineal. I get you. I get where you're going.
Well, no, the way it's written, including,
oh, okay,
you know, the metaphorical way that it's written,
the allegorical nature,
all
of
that
it,
stuff. That is exactly in keeping with how those cultures would do it. Okay, now you got it. Now you've got to throw yourself into the context of the thing.
Okay,
one thing that we say, right? You know, people in history, people that study history, study archaeology, we look at and believe in Christianity, we look at it and we go, look, if you look at all the historical evidence around the life of Jesus and you look at what happened, you look at Pontius Pilate, you know, all that, and you go, okay, I can figure out a couple of things from Jesus. He was either a liar, a madman, or he was the Son of God. You come to those three conclusions. It's one of those three.
There's a fourth one you're not admitting.
Give me one.
That he was a composite character that didn't exist.
Ooh.
Just like many other.
I just told you before this that there's more historical proof for the life that Jesus existed than there is Julius Caesar. So
I don't think that's true.
It is true.
Because I think that he had adversaries that wrote about him, and he had contemporaries that wrote about him. You had a lot of people who did not like Julius Caesar that wrote about him who were Romans.
Hear me out one more time. I'm talking to you right now.
All right, go.
There is more historical evidence of the life of Jesus actually existing than Julius Caesar.
I don't believe that.
See, I'm with this. I can understand that. I can go with absolutely 100%. Like, yeah, there's Jesus was alive. He was here on earth. He did some things that tripped some people out.
He was a great prophet.
I can go with that 100%. My thing is, you said it's not the Bible that has, like, that, I forget the words you use.
For the writings of a specific Jewish accountant at the time, Josephus?
You said the Bible isn't the problem, right? It isn't the problem, right? I would almost say and argue that it is.
Say that again. I don't understand.
You said the Bible, at one point you said the Bible isn't the problem in the argument, and I would say it almost that it is.
No, I'm saying that it's a historical. The Bible, as it's written, as it's compiled, 66 chapters, is historical in nature. It's not fantasy. It's not fairy tale. The way it's written, the way it's compiled, it is actually a historical document.
And I agree with you to an extent. It's definitely got history in it. I don't know, like, shoot for shoot. Exchange that word for what you will.
Thank you, but, John. I appreciate that. He's keeping it family friendly.
PG, but again, like, I'm a huge. I just started becoming a huge conspiracy theorist in the past like 3 or 4 years.
Thank you, Joe Rogan.
Thank you, Joe Rogan.
The conspiracy theorist.
You've ruined my life now.
Keep going back in time. You're gonna find conspiracies all right? the way back.
Exactly. And friends look at me weird now. They're like, "Dude, what are you, crazy?" And I'm like, "I don't know, man. I mean, just think about it."
Are you talking like American conspiracies?
American, German, Egyptian. We can go back as far as you want to go.
Sumerian.
Like anything, and that's what brought me to the point where you said, hey, the Bible is not the problem. And I would almost argue that it is, not so much as the stories or the thing that are like the idea or ideology that it's trying to bring, just that the people who wrote it, like, I understand they're okay, we're trying to make sure that people are good, you treat everybody right, and you know, that there's this all high power that if we believe in and we devote our life to them, we can go to heaven. If you don't and you mess with them and you curse them out, you go to hell. I'm cool with the stories. Like, hey, yeah, you want to be a better person. But at the same time, I'm like, the people who made these stories, but who wrote this down, who's to say they didn't slightly change it? Who's to say they didn't change it to for their being or their own personal gain? That's my problem.
Because it doesn't help anybody who's trying to do that.
You don't know that it doesn't help anybody.
No. Whenever
it's a post hoc fallacy. You can't go there, man.
What's that?
You don't know if it benefited them.
Because we don't know for 100 who wrote it.
Let me say it like this.
Go ahead. I'm here. I'm listening, buddy.
For somebody who truly follows Christianity the way it's supposed to be followed. The way it's supposed to be followed, not, you know, adding, subtracting, living a kind of life. It does not make sense for that person. It doesn't help that person do evil things.
Okay.
And if you can come up with one, just even one thing, and you got to back it up with the book, because we're talking about the book. Back it up with the book. Tell me what evil thing. And if the interesting thing is this: as soon as we start talking about evil and good.
Yeah,
we get outside of the atheist world because they don't believe in evil or good.
Oh, I do believe there is.
But that's not an atheist. That's not atheist. If you're an atheist,
I'm not an objectivist. That's for sure.
I mean, when you think about it, it's like, well, who are you to say what's evil, what's good, and what's bad?
Well, it's like, yeah, is there?
I don't know. Slicing the tips off of a baby's penis is pretty freaking evil.
Yeah. Okay, but why?
But why? Compulsorily doing it is.
How dare
evil.
You? See, and that's a that's
how dare I?
That's the problem.
You believe that these babies are born perfect, creations of God, and then the first thing you do is slice the tip of
their penis off.
Exactly.
Like, what is?
Oh, look, I'm not Jewish.
The framework.
I'm not
being
Jewish.
I know. That.
I don't think that's like, you know, that's not my thing. But what I would say is, well, wait a minute. Why do you feel that that's evil?
Because you're
like, where does that line start? Get out.
The baby has no agency.
Do me a favor.
The baby has no.
Do me a favor.
Baby has no choice.
Go out.
And you're inflicting pain
on
the baby.
Go outside of religion and do the same thing now.
I just did.
No, you didn't.
The baby has no agency.
No, no, no,
and you're
no, no,
inflicting
no.
harm on it
you're,
without its opinion.
Yeah. I get it. But you're talking about the Jewish faith. The Jewish faith does
okay.
that, right? Oh. Go outside the Jewish faith and now talk about
Name
something
me
else.
A kindness that a Christian can do for someone that an atheist can't.
No one ever said that.
No, I'm saying that the problem goes both ways.
What do you mean?
You're saying name a specific thing that an atheist can do, right?
No.
What are you saying? Name a...
No, name an evil thing, a thing that you consider evil... But it's not a religious thing. It could be a cultural thing.
Exorbitant interest.
Nice.
Double parking.
See, that's why they call them. That's why they call them the. They call you the.
Not paying your taxes.
They call you the political aid.
Taxation is theft.
Taxation.
Taxation is the price of a civil society, in my opinion.
What did Jesus say about taxation? Let me see your coin.
Caesar's.
Let me see your coin.
That's not on there.
Who's on the coin?
Lady Liberty is, also known as Columbia.
Render unto Lady Liberty what is Lady Liberty's.
Well,
render unto God what
like
is God's.
Roads? You like fire departments? You like police departments?
I mean, you know, it's a double-edged sword, man. You don't.
Yeah, but who's
you don't
who,
like it?
Who knows what and or who God is? So you were like, yeah. Praise unto
let
God.
Me ask you a question. Do you think that you're living in the smartest, most enlightened generation that'll ever be?
No. Actually, I think our generation is going on a decline right now.
Okay. All right. So let's follow that down then. We're so quick to look at people of the past and go, oh, they were animals. They were not smart as us. They weren't as wise as us. And yet, if we look at somebody 600 years from now, let's say human beings last 600 years from now, who knows? 1,000 years from now, they're going to look back at us.
At this rate, I don't think so.
Yeah, maybe not. But
maybe another
but
200.
But if we're lucky. Even the 200, the people 200 years from now, the human beings are going to look back at us and go, they were idiots.
You elected Donald Trump? What?
Yeah, they were idiots. Wow, they were, and it
the
swings.
Man voted for a billionaire?
It what? Swings back and forth. What's popular swings back and forth. What's
It's a pendulum.
Edgy
pendulum
swims
pretty,
back
that's,
and forth.
Told through history.
So though. My point is this. When you talk about somebody who wrote history down, right? Because, again, we've got to draw a line in the sand and say, look, either all of history is not valid or we draw a line in the sand and there is valid history that we can believe in.
Nah, you can't get, even get you behind can't do the that, historians. Though.
Why not?
Because let me ask you, how many people wrote the Bible?
I don't know.
How many?
That's
how many?
That's a trick question.
How many authors are there in the Bible?
I don't know. Less than 66. Oh,
less geez. Than 66.
Well, there's 66 Bibles, but there was some. Well, God wrote the Bible, but you're saying physically wrote the Bible.
Physically wrote
right,
the he's Bible.
Physically wrote okay. the Bible.
How many people physically like story like each? Not one person wrote
less,
every
less
chapter
than, less than
or
66.
Every. Less than 66. You're telling me in less.
I didn't go to seminary.
And all that makes two of us.
Read the Bible.
You're telling me in those 66 people, nobody had a slight, like, you know, let me just make this story this way so people will think
it
this way. Let me.
I'll tell you this. I'm glad you said that, John.
But I'm glad. Hold on. Let me get there now.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
So there's 66 people, and there's not somebody that had their alternative personal gain.
I'm glad you said that, John.
Personal gain because
I'm glad you
there's
said that.
12 disciples and one in there. Just out of 12, one wanted their own personal gain.
I'm glad you said that, John. I'm glad you said that, John. This is the reason why. Because if you look at the stories in the Bible, nobody who's looking for personal gain or to make themselves look better would have written it that way.
Solomon would have.
No. Actually,
see, this is only...
Solomon screwed up big time. Solomon screwed up big time.
How do you make yourself look really humble? You make yourself have... Really,
what are you talking about?
How do you make yourself look humble? You have acceptable faults. You have problems that are acceptable.
Let me tell you something. Anybody who's writing history, their own history, to make themselves like to for
better.
Gain, for better,
for personal gain,
would not have written the Bible the way they did. There, God has God's
it's
followers.
A compelling story.
God's followers are the biggest F-ups. That you've ever seen, the biggest hypocrites, the biggest, why? Because they're human beings. And why is it true? Because the people that are writing about it are not proud of what actually happened. But guess what? They were truthful.
I agree with you.
Do you agree with me?
I do. I agree with you. Like, because I, when I got baptized the second time, I was like, man, I'm just this complete screw up. I want to say 16.
Here's the problem with Christianity and Christians.
You might also say it makes for a better and more compelling story that they had so many faults and flaws.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
but,
then
it
was
but,
like,
but
you know
they
what?
Don't, but
this
don't,
is the one religion that I can
see,
come to and
can't.
I'm forgiven.
I could be a murderer.
Guys,
I could
just wipe my feet, wash
guys,
my hands,
his,
and I'm good.
His,
I'll be clean.
His first point, yeah, but his first point was, John's first point was this. Didn't they write it like they were making themselves look better and da da da? No, they didn't.
No, I didn't.
Okay, well, if they didn't write it to make themselves look better, maybe they wrote it themselves not to look good, so they're still trying to screw us.
Okay.
You guys are in the position of the Bible's trying to screw you, and it's not.
See, no. That's where you're getting me wrong there, because I'm not taking it as a position of trying to type of screw you. Like I said, I'm a conspiracy theorist. My whole thing is religion is control. Like if you follow this, I got you. Like you are controlled, you are understanding, like whatever I say jump, you say how high. Like that's my understanding, and
John,
that's the
John,
my understanding
John,
that I've come to as
I'll give
late.
You, I'll give you this, John. I'll give you one old saying. If you don't stand up for something, you'll fall for anything.
And I completely agree. I used to stand up
so
for
what
Christianity
so what
right
you,
now.
So what do you stand up for?
Right now I stand up for that there is an afterlife. I don't know what it consists of.
That's
but
fair.
I know it consists of my consciousness, which is a separate being of me. My consciousness is just inhabiting
and
this
you,
body
and you said
as
yourself,
far as I'm known.
You said yourself you're still trying to figure it out. You're still trying to find
I'm still
answers.
Trying to figure it out. For all I know, I could go out there. I could go tomorrow, take some DMT, come back and be like, yo, Leo. Christianity's right, bro.
Here's
like,
the
like
here's,
you are 100% right. I went back. I saw some visions. I saw the dude with the beard. I already know.
Here's the problem, and it goes way deeper than this.
That's what I'm saying.
Way deeper, but I'm gonna give you this.
I'm a conspiracy.
I'm gonna give you just a little bit, okay? If you look into yourself. For answers that could never be come from within yourself, if they're bigger than you and you're looking within yourself for those answers, you'll never find them.
Okay.
It's the number one flaw. People looking, they go, I'm going to meditate. And I meditate. I love meditation because it does help me figure out who I am on a, you know, on a level. But the problem is,
why do you want that is my question.
Talking to the atheist.
Why would you want such an answer?
Once again, that's an existential question everybody is going to ask at some point.
Everyone wants to know the purpose in life, but if you knew your purpose in life, what value would that add to your life?
Well, if you believe in an afterlife, it would add to you.
What value does it add? It doesn't change your circumstances. I'm not even really looking for
it. It doesn't change your what?
It doesn't change your circumstances whatsoever. You're still here.
You how
still
does it not change your circumstances?
You're still here on Earth.
It depends on what you believe.
You have no more power over
your
life.
You don't have... Look, in Stephen Jay Gould, you don't have a purpose in life as an atheist.
I don't want one. I don't need one.
Because you're settling for that.
I'm very happy with my life as it is.
I would argue...
I think that if I was given a purpose, I would feel overwhelmed by the burden of it.
But what if I told you you wouldn't?
No, I would be.
No, what if I told you you wouldn't?
No matter what the purpose is, I would feel overwhelmed by the burden of it.
Why do you believe that?
Because I didn't choose it.
Why do you believe that?
What do you mean?
Well, if you did choose it, why would you believe that you wouldn't be, you'd be overwhelmed?
Because it's not something I get to choose. That's why.
It is something you get to choose.
If I got to choose my purpose.
You have free choice. You have free choice to say what you're saying right now.
Exactly. So what difference does it make if there is or isn't a God? You don't get an answer one way or the other.
Well, you do get an answer.
No, you don't. Obviously, if you have free choice to choose your
burden.
How
do you know you don't get an answer? We're going back to our problem
here. No.
No.
It's talking in circles.
It's not talking in circles.
It is, because it is. You either get choose your purpose or you don't.
It is talking in circles.
Tell me.
We were going over here.
Tell me. I don't want to talk in circles, so tell me how that's talking in circles. What part?
I think he's struggling with the problem. He's trying to find answers to questions that he doesn't know the answers to. And if he finds the answers to them, he's going to have more questions.
And it's a never-ending cycle.
And that's a good thing, though.
I've come to a point where it's like, it's not even just about, is there a God? Is there an afterlife? Is there this? It's like, hey, what's going on here? What's the deal?
Why does a human being worry about that, and why does a human being not worry about that?
I don't know. That's our nature.
Because everybody's different.
Everybody's got a different point of view.
I agree. It is our nature, and what I would call that is a God-shaped hole. And you know what? He rolls his eyes at that, but that is the answer that I have.
A God-shaped hole.
God-shaped hole. What does that even look like?
You guys.
That's a good question.
Let me tell you. You guys are filling this thing up. You're filling it up with all these things, and then you get to a point where you go, I've tried everything and nothing's worked, and.
For me, it's just the experience.
It's just the number of times I've heard this. I'm not laughing at you.
No.
I've heard this so many times.
No, I get that, but
let me... It's like, I don't have a hole in me. I'm not broken. I'm not missing anything.
Really?
For Eric.
I have questions that I need answered, I feel I've gotten a lot of the answers to a
satisfaction.
Yeah, I do.
Have you?
I feel like I've learned what I need to know to accept certain truths about reality.
Why are you here? Why are you living? What's the point?
Eric,
what difference would an answer to that question make? That's
you
what
would
I've
be
learned.
You would be able to live with a purpose in your life, and
his
be able
purpose,
to live with
Eric.
A purpose.
What's your purpose right now? Just to live, be happy, and live life, right?
Yeah.
Well, if that's
Leo, what's your purpose right now?
You really want to know that?
Yeah, come on, man. Cut it. Give me. We're on Twitter right now. 144 characters or less.
My purpose. If my purpose was to be successful, and I didn't get it, I'd be distraught.
I'm answering the question.
If my purpose was to be the smartest guy in the world, smart, not wise, smartest guy in the world, like Eric, because he's close.
I want to give you an honest answer to that.
I'm trying to answer his question.
All right, then go ahead, Leo. We're gonna come back to Eric. I'm taking over the podcast.
Right.
I'm asking the question.
I like it. I think he's doing a great job. I think he's doing a good job. So, if I wanted to be the smartest guy in the world. And I became the smartest guy in the world, I'd still not be happy, because then what, right? My purpose in life is in making sure that I am trying to get as close in relationship with God as possible, and And this is not just because I'm a Christian. Yes, atheists can do this. Yes, people that want to do DMT, which is what?
Dimethyltryptamine.
Man,
yeah, I can't say that.
Big ups to Joe Rogan. maybe he'll see this, right? Maybe you end up finding something, but my life, if I can try to be as close to God as possible, have a real relationship, not this BS that you guys keep seeing out there in the world, not this
not
like
the folk Christians,
not this lip service that Eric's
not only on Sundays
that
Christians.
Yeah. Not that garbage, but the real relationship with God, with the maker, the one that created all this, that I believe created all this, right?
Okay.
If I can do that, and that's his first commandment. Second commandment is to love people as I love myself. That means being selfless. That means trying to make you guys' life better for knowing me.
Okay.
Then I would have served my purpose on earth.
Amen.
Okay, so my short answer?
Yeah, 144 characters less.
I just want to be a better person than I was yesterday.
And how do you know?
I'm only in this race against myself.
Let me ask
not
you,
competing
let
against
me ask you,
the
let me,
7 billion people on Earth.
Let me ask you this. No, me neither.
It's a lot of people to compete with.
No, me neither. But let me ask you this. And this is a problem that...
I want to be a kinder person than I was yesterday.
But
I want to be a more
how do you
patient person.
How do you know you're being kind? Because if you go into a different culture, being kind means something completely different.
Yeah, you go over in the Middle East, being kind is beating a woman for...
Yeah,
wearing a skirt and showing a little leg.
You're doing. Where's that derived from, though? Like,
you're doing her a favor. You're doing her a favor.
From Muslims and Christians.
You feel me? Jesus was the guy who stopped them from stoning the woman.
I don't.
And told them to the guy. What was it? The guy who's he without sin. Throw the first stone.
Cast the first stone.
Right. So you tell me, how do you measure what kindness is?
Well,
and
hold
how
on,
do you know
hold
you've
on,
gotten
hold on, hold on. Like I said, I took over this podcast.
Go for it. Oh, I just gave you my answer. My purpose in life is to try to be a better person than I was yesterday.
And that's
whatever that means.
And every single day of my life, I try to be a better person than I was
whatever
before
that means. But what's your measurement?
And your purpose
how do you know
is to be closer to God, right?
I think about it.
Yeah, be closer to God and to love people more than I love myself.
Exactly. So, I mean, so... He's not even a Christian. He wants to be better than himself.
But what
and
does
he
that
still,
mean?
And he still wants to be kinder to the people.
But what does that mean?
What do you mean?
Opening my wallet when someone needs food.
Okay.
Being kind-hearted, like, obviously.
Please give me
and okay. Gary,
let me give you,
you
a, let me give you a contextual
to...
example.
Give me some more rules
no,
from your
let me
life
give you a contextual example.
The rules.
You're driving down the road, and you see somebody on the side of the road. Do you stop and help them? Have you ever done that?
Yes.
To a complete stranger?
Yes.
How often do you do it?
Not enough.
Okay.
I'm not a perfect human being. I wish I was, but
be.
I'm not.
And that's the problem.
What's the
you've
problem?
Got this epitome paradigm you're trying to shoot for.
What does that mean?
You're trying to be the best you can be in God's eyes.
No. Wrong.
You're not trying to be what God wants you to be.
Wrong.
I mean,
I'm not trying to be the best that I can be in God's eyes. I'm trying to have a relationship with God.
Okay, and that means honoring
his
wishes.
That's a huge difference because if you love your parents, if you love them, do you guys love your parents? First of all, let me ask that.
To an extent.
To an extent, right?
No, I'm kidding. Love you, Mom. Love you, Pops.
if you love your parents,
you too, Christy
today,
and Rich.
My mom's listening. Happy birthday, Mom.
Oh, hey, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Mom.
What do I call her?
Alice.
Happy birthday. Oh, I love that name.
Alicia.
God, I love that name more. Mm. Gosh, Spanish people got it right, man. That's all I got to say. So listen. If you love your mom and your dad, or your mom or your dad, right? If you love them, really love them, think about somebody you love like a father if you don't have a father figure. Think about somebody you love, your mom, who's not your mother, if you don't have a mom. Like, just think about that person.
Okay.
How do you show them love?
I'm gonna poke a hole in this right off the bat.
Yeah, let's see about that.
You know what's really cool about my mom? I can text her and I can get a response back. In clearly describes exactly what I need to know.
I can pray to God and I actually get an answer back.
And see, that's where I would say you're
see,
deluded.
No, that, and that exactly.
Like
now, how do you know you're getting an
you
answer
know
back?
But
right
how
answer
do you know I'm deluded? Do I shove marbles up my ass?
You might.
We're talking about the
you do on your own time, buddy.
Listen, we're talking about metaphysics here. We're talking about metaphysics.
If you get an answer that's meaningful to you,
do you believe
in
metaphysics? Do you believe in metaphysics? Do you believe that exists as a science?
Well, the concept of I understand the concept of metaphysics. I wouldn't say I believe that metaphysics applies to this situation.
See, he doesn't believe in a god. Let me talk to a guy who believes in a god but just doesn't know who that god is. Okay, so you believe in a god, right?
Yeah, I believe in a higher power.
A higher power.
Whether it's one, whether it's seven of them, whether it's the one of the sun, one of the moon.
You just don't know.
I know there's a higher power.
Okay. Now, where does that higher power live?
See, that's where my questions come in play, because that higher power could either be the afterlife or like where I'll talk about, our consciousness goes to another realm or reality.
Okay, but you're saying that higher power doesn't live here. Like he can't walk through the door right now and talk to us.
No, Why not? I don't say that he doesn't live here. Okay. And like I said, man, when I find answers, there's only more questions to follow, or like you guys said that.
Yeah, that's what happens. You ever seen Fantasia?
Yes.
With Mickey Mouse.
Yeah. Loved it as a kid.
So it's called the Sorcerer's Apprentice paradox, right? As soon as you cut a problem in half, now you've got two new problems.
Yeah.
You cut those two problems in half, now you've got four.
I call that Hail Hydra.
That's the nature of.
But you know what we need to do.
Curiosity is, if you get curious enough, you're gonna find an answer, and that's gonna lead you to two new questions.
That's why curiosity.
Let me tell you. Let me tell you.
Or
let
more
me,
than two.
Let me tell you the big problem here. The big problem.
Hold on.
Hey, he's running the podcast.
My bad.
You asked me, Gad. Asked me about God, if he's walking in through the door.
Sorry about that. All right.
And in my eyes, like there's two things, and I can neither confirm nor deny. The one, which is I don't know, but then as far as I can see, there's a higher power somewhere out there. And then there's another side where there's the whole DMT thing, where we can contact another realm or reality, whatever it is. Maybe it's our subconscious. I don't know. But it's weird that grass, flowers, dogs, deers, wolves, trees, and us as human beings all have DMT in our system.
Pineal gland.
We're all connected through that. So maybe in some weird way, that's a god on somebody else's thing. Like, that's how we're connected. That's our own, like, being that's connected all of us, that, like, Mother Nature is our god. But that's a whole nother ball game where I haven't even tapped into yet, where I'm, like...
We could talk about that a long
time. All...
I'm just touching the surface
We're all but dust. Dust. Adam was breathing into life, and he was but dust. We're all but dust. That's something that
I'm kind of proud of.
In the Christian world... totally acknowledge.
I'm kind of proud of our evolution, to be perfectly honest.
What's that mean?
Of the history of humanity and our evolution. I'm really proud of it, actually.
Which part?
All of it. All of going from a protocell to us now.
All the sapiens and homos out there.
99% of all the species that have ever existed are extinct, and we're still here.
That's
freaking cool.
For now. And it hasn't been that long.
Until we blow ourselves up.
Until we do something really stupid and you know, make our ecosystem non-sustainable.
Trump's president.
The planet will go on. I just want to point that out.
Yeah, the planet's going to live on. We'll die off before the planet.
Well, Mr. Astrophysicist, we don't know that because there could be a, what do they call that? A something event?
What a
cataclysmic?
Extinction level event for the Earth.
Astronomical.
What are you talking? I don't know what you're referring to.
Like,
give me more depth.
Neil deGrasse Tyson talks about. Is that a good guy to listen to? By the way,
he's cool.
Okay,
he's cool.
Neil deGrasse.
He's super smart, by the way.
Tyson talks about.
Way smarter than me.
Like first of all, the dust or the garbage that's out there, right?
Around the Earth,
the
satellites,
space garbage, and then he talks about the fact that they're easily.
Panspermia.
What?
Panspermia is the concept.
Why is there
about.
Sperm in that?
It's just the concept of life jumping from planet to planet.
Whose idea was that?
I don't remember.
Sperm?
Panspermia.
Why is sperm in there?
Sperm brings life.
Listen up. Depends on where it goes.
Yeah. Exactly. That's why the word is panspermia. You got to put it everywhere.
Put it everywhere and hope something comes back.
I completely forgot what I was even going to say.
The So where were we going with this? The whole concept of...
I completely forgot. I think he's done. No, he threw me off.
He freaking buttoned it all up. He wrapped it in a nice bow, man.
But I want to go back to where we got on this topic, and that's with proof of things that have happened in the Bible. So the people with the most interest in proving that the Bible happened as it happened. And let's cut off the New Testament, right?
Human beings.
No. Let's cut off the New Testament. So the people with the most invested in proving that the Old Testament happened are Hebrew people, the Jewish. The nation of Israel commissioned an archaeological study to prove that the Exodus happened.
It makes sense. It's part of their culture.
And guess what happened?
It makes sense.
They found no evidence of the Exodus at all.
Okay.
So we're talking...
I don't believe that.
We're talking, what is it, years of slavery in Egypt, no proof.
What study?
I'll look it up for you and I'll give it to you.
See, that's the thing.
I'll find it for you and I'll give it to you.
We throw stuff out there. People throw stuff out there and say, and you think
I'm not throwing it out there. I'm quoting what I've read. What I've read is that in the interest of proving that, you know, finding some archaeological proof, they wanted to find some evidence of Moses living in Egypt. They wanted to find evidence of the Pharaoh.
Did you know that there's
Ramses?
There's things written about in the archaeological. There's things in our historical record that haven't been proven in the archaeological record yet.
And there's things in the archaeological record that conflict with the Bible. One of them is the city of Alamarna.
Wait a minute.
Okay, you know what? Look up the city of Alamarna. Alamarna conflicts with the entire account of the Old Testament.
But let me say this.
With the Exodus.
Let me say this, though. Okay. Let me say this. All right.
I'm sorry. I had to bring it back.
No, you're good. You're good. You're good because I got many questions about the Bible.
An 80-year-old. 80-year-old.
Yeah.
Not 90.
Archaeological, almost 90. He might have been 89. Archaeology professor that I had. All right. He was an atheist.
Okay.
All right. Now, we didn't talk about God. We didn't talk about any of that because obviously he was an atheist. He didn't believe in that. But one thing that he said was, look, the one problem that we have in archaeology is archaeologists that put papers out there, right? They publish. And they go, this is it. And the thing that you got to realize as an archaeologist...
You got to leave room for, more history.
The archaeologist always has to have in the back of their mind that this is the oldest
known.
Because you never know. You keep digging a little bit more and you find something a little bit older. We thought Lucy was the oldest and then bam.
That's a horrible example.
Whatever.
I'm not going to credit you that one.
All right, fine.
That's a horrible example because Lucy was an example of a transitional fossil.
I'm half drunk.
Okay.
I've had three beers now, okay? So
Go for the fourth.
I don't even have a fourth.
Aww.
All we have is rum.
No, we do.
All right, so...
It's hiding behind you. There's a fourth beer behind the rum.
Oh, my gosh.
Number four.
Bum, bum, bum.
All right, can I finish my interview with him, please?
Yes, let's roll it out.
All right, let's... We're so far past the MMA and
it's
and
all
everything.
Good. It doesn't even matter. I enjoy this. This is why I was so excited when I came in
here.
Are you
having a good time? Having a good time?
You know what? If you're really curious about conspiracy theories, you got to look up the city of Alamarna.
The city of Alamarna. See,
it's the
with
best
the conspiracy
theory
in
the world, man.
I just got into it with moving in with my roommate, Evan, which, man, you guys got to have him on. He's way smarter than I am. I'm just like the tip of the iceberg. This guy... blows my mind every time, but at the same time, I'm like, shut up. All right, I can't deal with the conspiracy theory anymore.
It's too much.
If I keep going down this hole, I'm never going to come out. But with that, I didn't get into it until the whole this past election where I was like, well, all these emails are coming out. Let me dig a little deeper.
Are you a Hillary person?
Oh, hell no. I mean, no. I'm not a Hillary person.
Really?
I was a Rand Paul person.
Oh, wow. Look at that.
I die hard Rand Paul.
I had no qualms with him.
I wrote him in.
You know what I wanted? I wanted Rand Paul and I wanted Bernie to debate.
Yeah.
Because I thought that they had opposing viewpoints on a lot of things.
Is the hookah done?
Yeah, it's done.
Dang, nabbit.
But I was like, this whole thing of he said, she said, and then like the emails started coming out, and I was like, well, what? I started listening to my buddy more and more because he'd talk about this before, and I'm like, dude, you're just crazy. You don't know what you're talking about. You're one of those. And then all of a sudden, everything started coming out on the news, and it's like, hey, Hillary's got these emails that said this, and Podesta's got these emails that said that, and Pizzagate this.
She should be in jail, and that's the last thing I'm going to say. She should be in jail for for that, if that's right, if she did that with those emails, and if that's our you know, nation's secrets and yada yada, she should be in jail. Anybody else would be in jail. She should be in jail. She's 70 years old. She's having strokes. Life sucks for Hillary. She didn't become president like she wanted to. Now put her in jail. Put a nice bow on that.
Yeah.
All right.
But that's what got me into it, and I started diving deeper and deeper, and I had more and more questions, and before I got too deep, I was like, all right, let's just call this time out. I need to get back to work and, like, not lose my mind and go crazy on this.
Man, I was going to ask you so many more questions about Beyond Strength, and
come on, man.
Do you?
I'll probably be going to the gym.
Do you realize? Oh, that's cool. Yeah.
Come on in. Come in and check us out.
Let me tell you, because they'll change your freaking life. But do you know that I was not going to get into the
religion,
and then he just brings it up? Is that insane or what? Is that awesome?
Right. That's when I walked in, I was like, oh, I'm going everywhere with this. He's an atheist. He's a Christian. Dude, oh, I'm going to take this over.
Do you realize that me and Eric love going to this level?
This is good stuff. Afterwards, we'll talk about this. It's the Atenists. The Atenists were like the oldest known monotheists. Okay. After Hindus.
Hey, but you're going to have to talk to me after you talk to him, because I'm going to refute half of what he says.
Nah, you can't.
Right, man, you guys are going to have me back. I'm just phenomenal.
12th dynasty. Get older than that. It's older than
I'm going to have to come back with my friend Evan and just – I'll sit back, ask a question, and just sit back and watch you three just go at it.
I try to be chill about this. If that's the case, I really do.
I'm bringing Brett Andrews up in this piece if that's the case.
You won't be at it, but you'll definitely be like, but what about – but then there's – and then there's
– I'm bringing somebody greater than me if that's the case, because I can't be the only one.
We're just going to keep scaling up, and I'm just going to be out of my depth eventually.
Yeah, eventually we're not even going to talk anymore. I'm just like, I don't
just
even know what's going on.
Sit back and watch.
Yeah, we'll make jokes.
I'm going to start taking notes.
All right, listen, we got to get to...
wrap up.
No, I was going to say we got to get to Pop Culture Court.
Oh, wow, we never went there.
We never got there.
Let's do it.
And let me tell you something. Part of this thing is that we chop it all up, and we put it out on YouTube so people can just... come to the pop culture
clips that they care about. Yeah,
exactly. So it's something for everybody. Are you guys? Why do I keep doing that?
Doing what?
I keep accidentally touching my the slider.
Quit touching your board.
My board. Dismiss that. All right, guys. I'm gonna play a little song for everybody. All right. So this rapper impressed me with this song, and I'm gonna play the song.
I can see it, and I'm already upset.
I can't see it, and I'm getting irritated.
All right, you guys ready for this? Live, you won't be able to hear this.
Sorry, live.
Who are these Negroes chucking and jiving on this commercial?
All this gyrating.
Robert Randolph got soul in this. All right, here we go. You guys know this song?
Yes, I know this song.
He doesn't like it.
I've never heard this song.
I bounce in Arlington, so I've heard this song more times than I can count. And I can't count very high, so. People on live who don't know, it's Panda.
Panda. Panda. Panda.
Told you, I bounce in Arlington. I hear this a lot. Friday, Saturday.
I got broads in Atlanta. Just to be in the family. Credit cards in the scammers. Hitting the licks in the van.
It's got a woo! Alright, it's got a mean one.
Catchy. Yeah. But if you look at the lyrics, he's saying panda, panda, panda. Legacy, panda, panda. Selling ball. Man, I'm the macho like Randy. The chopper go out for granted.
Woo!
The
nigga bullet you got.
I honestly like.
That's all we can.
For all that it is, it's an awesome hook. It's catchy.
It's a good hook.
It's a club banger. But if you like rap, you're upset at this right now.
Now, listen. I love that song.
Do?
Because of what it does to me. But I don't love that song because of...
So that's like a workout song.
Yeah, it's a work. Exactly, it's a workout song. It's a dance song. You're going hard in the club with that song. But here's the problem. I watched another video with Designer after I got excited about Panda, and this guy is on crack cocaine.
He's actually on codeine.
He's on
Holy crap. You think he's doing the whole upside down thing where they like juice from the bag?
Dude, for sure.
This guy, his eyes, his eyes.
Balls to the wall.
I know. His hey, man, your lyrics, what would you just say?
His eyes are on permanent, what is it, 1,000-yard stare. And he goes, and like when he's starting off with his thing, he's like, he's, you know, the beat goes. And I'm just like,
Panda.
What Biggie is rolling around in his extra large coffin.
You know how you know, like, pop culture, not just pop culture, but hip hop is messed up today. And this is nothing against white rappers. And this is nothing against black rappers.
Nobody white
gonna,
in here.
I'm going to go there right now.
Do it.
So when there are more white rappers that are better than the black rappers,
that's a problem.
Because currently, right now, and again, this is nothing against black rappers.
I already
this
know what he's gonna
nothing
say.
Nothing against white rappers, but when you put on somebody like Lil Yachty, to 21 Savage or whatever his name is, and some other guy, I can't like. There's two Young Thug, and their rap comes on. They all they do is they have a crazy beat. Crazy beat,
awesome
that bangs
beat.
In the club, gets you hyped up. You start listening to it. You don't even know what the words are, but you're bouncing. You don't know why you're bouncing. You're bouncing, and the words are going like,
you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna take that clip and we're gonna put a beat to it.
let me tell you something.
It's gonna hit. It's gonna be a banger.
Jon Hughes dropping then, that new joint. Let me tell you something.
It's all about the producer now.
Yeah.
It's all about the person making the beat. And for the most part, except for a few rappers out there, it's all garbage.
But even like with with the producer, you got people like G-Eazy, Lil Dicky, and there's
Lil
some
Dicky
other white
ridiculous.
Guys out there. It's so good.
I don't even know how they make
the music.
Like
if you, it's now to the point in rap culture to where if you're white and you can rap, you're a hip hop.
Yeah, find a producer.
Yeah,
set.
Hey, you're hip hop. But if you're black and you can just rhyme a little bit,
garbage.
Like and you mumble, we're gonna put a beat on it. You're gonna be fired because you're gonna do what we're gonna say. But if you can really, really rap and you're black, you have to work twice, almost three times as hard to
kids,
get out there.
Kids out there.
I gotta put this out.
Listen,
eventually.
kids, please. That doesn't make any damn sense. If you're a great lyricist, you should be the best out there. You should be celebrated. Make your own beats. If you are a poser and you've got a great beat,
Lil Yachty,
I will not like you.
Future.
And you should not be liked. You should be hated, despised, killed, dragged.
Young Thug.
I only want to name drop two artists because they're both atheist hip-hop artists.
Oh.
They're freaking amazing.
There's such a thing?
There's an actual entire subculture of atheist hip-hop.
Just when I thought Christian rap was...
I'm not even joking.
I'm going to have to check this out.
It's awesome.
let's check this
out. The first guy I want to drop, he's the guy who kind of made it like really awesome. His name is Graydon Square. If you haven't heard of him, you should check it out.
Graydon Square?
Yeah, Graydon Square. Check out his first album. It's called The CPT Theorem. He's a... he lives in Arizona. He's a kid trying to get a physics degree. He's actually working on his master's right now in physics.
Nice.
Yeah. He wants
Very
to be a physicist.
Nice.
He calls himself the Black Carl Sagan. So it's such good hip-hop. And then the other guy, Spanfly. Spanfly's got a whole bunch of cool songs. This guy can rhyme. And I mean, when I first started becoming an atheist, these guys were starting to become popular.
Oh, okay.
So I was listening to a lot of their music, and I was like, wow, this is actually really good hip-hop.
Wait, when you first started to become atheist, did you Google search atheist rappers?
No, they started becoming popular as a result of it.
Okay, I got you.
Graydon Square was part of something called the Rational Response Squad, And I know one of the founding members of that Rational Response.
They are not paying for this podcast right now.
I'm not plugging them. They're defunct. They don't operate anymore.
Shameless plug.
They don't operate anymore. But they were like promoting these hip hop artists as a way of connecting with youth, and it worked.
Take off your shirt, Elise. Ah, you hear? Have you been here the whole time? You're the best.
She wants David, him to take his shirt off.
Who? Which one? This guy?
Because he don't want to see that. I got to stand up so my rolls don't fall over each other.
John is literally the sexiest guy in here right now.
You lifted your shirt up earlier, so she caught a whiff.
Yeah, just a little whiff of that sexiness. Hey, listen. No.
You have to play some of their music and try it out. You're probably going to be like, wow, this guy.
Everybody, did you hear the shameless plug? Go ahead and check that out. But wait. Court is in session. We've got to listen to the bad designer thing, all right? So you guys ready for bad designer?
Bad designer.
That was good, but we just listened to Panda, and that was amazing.
I don't know about all that, but yeah.
it had a cool
It was all right.
He's right. No, you know what? I am overhyping, but let's listen to Terrible Designer.
It gets you going. Now we're going
to
listen to Terrible Designer.
Terrible Designer. Here we go. A designer freestyle a cappella on Westwood.
What?
Westwood, Tim Westwood TV.
Here I thought you meant like Westworld.
No.
Yeah, that's...
I just seen that.
That's awesome.
TV. Tim Westwood TV, designer of the building. What a family.
What up,
baby?
What up?
Oh, my days. Wow. Oh, my days. Styles on top of styles.
What are you doing? I blame all this on Lil Jon.
Yeah.
Here he goes. Guys, watch this on your own YouTubes.
My niggas be mobbing all day. 50 shots in the K. I let it spray. Get tackled by bullets. You get my way. My life is a game, so I'm ready to play. I'm selling that kumbaya. You sniffing that yay. Fuck what you say, because the nigga get shot. Towing that Glock and the nigga get popped. Now, if you out there, be snitching the cops. Think I'm a baby, but no, I ain't Jody. Pick up that 40 for holy your moly the way. I got 2 foot. You think I cold? Smoking no dope because I get that Cody. If you got problem, I'm calling my bros. Keep fucking so good and your pussy gets full. Bullets at you and your damage is so. This is what happened. You tell what you told. Whipping the bread like a slave on the stove. Killing that bitch booty. Now she dead ass. Hundreds of thousands of making that cash. Smoking no scope and I call it that blast.
On the one side, you can understand them, but you can't. And then on the other side, you're just like, he's just saying words and just emphasizing the, like,
did DMX get some rhythm?
Right? I went to the store and got some groceries. I put it in my bag and then I'm gonna go.
Shut your mouth about DMX. He's amazing. He has a drug problem.
DMX found some rhythm.
Took a little he has trip an to issue. Jamaica. He got a lot of money.
Got some rhythm.
Came out the ghetto.
Be quiet. Hey, be quiet. Be quiet.
Whole team got beans with me. Smoke an A, put an A on it. Fuck your bitch, put a face on it. See the sucker, taste the taste on it. I be like, go make on it. Hey, take on it. I don't know what I'm going to do today. Cock back, then I shoot the K. You be talking shit, I use the J.
I don't know what I'm going to do today. I cock back and I shoot the K. Come with me. Come on, man.
I wonder how he ranks.
That guy.
You ever seen the ranking?
That guy's a star. Yeah, that guy's a star.
Where is it? There's like a ranking thing.
Whatever.
Out there.
That guy's a star. All right, we gotta deliberate. Wait a minute.
If he's a good rapper or not?
No, they take the spread of vocabulary in the first 20,000 words.
Oh, I know what you're talking
about.
I got you. Yeah.
And they say they rank them based on who
I've
used the
that.
Most variants of words and. You know.
DMX is low on there, but they give him a compliment, and they're like, but he's low on here, but he's also has the best delivery of the lower people.
All right. You know what?
Can we just not play Panda anymore or designer?
Right, we're done.
Whatever his name is.
I know. I call him Panda, too.
That's the only song I know him
That's
by
the only
him
good
is Panda.
One. That's it. All right.
And it only sounds good when a DJ scratches it with some other things.
I know. It's so good when they, you know, like they put a good rapper next
yes,
to it.
Yes, and put a nice beat behind it
All right,
and give
kids,
him a big bass drop.
Kids, we're going to deliberate. You can see my man Jon Hughes over here. He's down with it.
Kids, today rap is crap.
Rap is the garbage.
And not the country rap. That's good crap.
That's a curious beast right there. Like, what kind of weird like science experiment was that?
I don't know, but
some producer
funny...
was like, "Hey, let's put a rapper."
Somebody
with a
started
artist.
With Bubba Sparks, and then somebody was like, "You know what? I can make more of this. I can do this. This can hit.
This can work. We can sell this. We can sell this to two awful demographics.
Man,
we don't
wrong.
At the same time.
We don't have a designer." with two eyes.
Aesop Rock's at the top.
Aesop Rocky? Really?
He's at the top.
Really?
7,392 unique words. Where's
Kendrick?
I would not put him at the top.
Where's Kendrick?
let's see. Cool Keith's up there. Cannabis.
What?
I could see Cannabis, but who? Roots, Cool Keith?
RZA. Wu-Tang
Cool Keith?
The Roots and RZA I can see, but who the heck is Cool Keith?
Ghostface Killah.
Well, yeah, Ghostface.
That's my hero right there. He's my favorite rapper of all time.
Yeah, Ghostface makes sense. Who's Cool Keith?
Yeah, that's the one I'm talking about.
I don't like this algorithm.
Like if you go over, the DMX one, he's like he has great delivery and the way he does it.
Oh,
but
yeah.
he used the simplest of words.
Nobody beats Biggie. I don't care who you are.
Drake is like right near DMX.
Hey,
like right.
Can you please tell the? Hey, hold on.
I almost want to break your iPad or window pad for saying Drake is near DMX.
Light skin.
No. I mean in ranking.
Light
even
skin.
That.
Light skin brothers unite. Hey, seriously though, can you please tell them what you're looking at?
Oh yeah, sure. It's a post over at pudding.cool, and it's the largest vocabulary in hip hop. Just Google the largest vocabulary in hip hop.
The largest vocabulary in hip hop. Or on Google.
Yeah, just Google it. It's going to be at
pudding.cool. That doesn't mean a damn thing. There's so much more to hip-hop. Now,
it's good, but...
We're talking about designer.
It's the first 5,000 words they use in all of their music. So.
I don't care. I don't care about that, Sharon. All I care about...
Sharon,
is this. Is Designer a good rapper, or is he garbage? Where should we put him?
Garbage.
One for garbage. Two for garbage. Three for garbage.
Garbage, garbage, garbage.
But check out that Panda song. That's awesome. I love Panda. But every other song, you're in the garbage, Mr. Panda Designer.
What's the sentence?
Panda.
That's the sentence.
Panda.
I got bras in Atlanta. Panda.
I got bras in Atlanta. I don't even know what
panda.
It's like it's almost tribal. When he gets you like in this.
panda.
Getting in there somewhere deep. Huh?
All right, that concludes, guys. We got to stop it at some point. We're already an hour and 13 minutes over.
Wow, that's awesome.
That's how much fun we had with this guy. Is he coming back?
Yes.
We don't know.
Bring me back, please.
We're gonna go ahead and let you guys vote. Should Jon Hughes come back? I say yes. One vote for yes.
Two votes for yes.
Two votes for yes.
If my vote counts, I count yes.
Three votes for yes. All we need is your votes to make sure he's coming back, and I think he will.
Maybe next time we'll actually talk about BSP and...
And we will talk about BSP and fighting, but we actually did have a long conversation about stairs and crap. But anywho, please like our page at symbol Righteous Anger Podcast on Facebook, or you can go to our website, righteousangerpodcast.com, or you can go to Twitter, at Righteous Anger Podcast, or you can send me a letter.
Don't send letters.
Don't mail him anything.
I'm not giving you my address.
You're lost in the mail.
All right, guys. Thank you for watching. Peace out. And that's the show. Nice. Gangster.